Thank you very much, ladies and gentlemen. We're going to start the final session of the MAG meeting today. I will just hand it over to the chair right now without any further ado.
Thank you, Chengatai. I think we had a very good morning this morning and managed to get through a lot of the intersessional work, which of course is important because it should inform our work. And one of the things I'd like us to think about as a kind of future process enhancement as we go forward over this next year is to start working with Dynamic Coalition's best practice forums, the intersessional work, to get some early guidance from them as we look towards the next year for agendas and topics and themes. And I think to that extent, when we kind of are able to draw breath here in terms of trying to get through a lot of this work to establish a longer term horizon, given this is the first year of a 10-year run, and there's been a lot of support for sort of multi-year programs and a longer-term view, I think all of that will actually aid a lot of these processes going forward. I have to admit, in past years, it has from time to time felt like we were sort of resetting and starting over again, and I think we've had to do less of that this year, which has enabled us to make some fairly speedy progress this morning. So I have to say I'm hoping that holds for this afternoon as well when we look for some speedy progress in terms of trying to agree a theme. And when we say a theme, it's pretty clear if you look at all the emails on the list that we're talking about a tagline or a title for the conference. I do think there were a couple of comments yesterday that said it would be quite helpful to add, you know, a paragraph or a few paragraphs that put a little bit of context to that theme and would actually help guide the discussions a bit more. I know past calls have listed the theme and the sub-themes, but I think to put some additional text that just talks about this is in the context of the 10-year renewal of the IGF and the SDGs just having been established, and maybe we do reference the climate change activities. We put it in that context. And help frame it overall, then hopefully we'll actually make some progress towards Flavio's excellent point yesterday where he said, in fact, well, we had the theme and, you know, very long discussions on theme. One of the proposals addressed it. The others were sort of more classic, I think you said, internet governance topics. So we'll see if we can take some steps this time in terms of trying to tie those things together a little bit more. So the work ahead of us this afternoon is the themes, which I think it's very important that we actually come out with a theme, a title for the conference today. I mean, again, we've all heard about the compressed timetable, but that will allow us to move forward with the call for workshops. We also need to have a position on sub-themes as well. And either we press forward and we kind of close on sub-themes, or we, I think there's been some emerging consensus around a hybrid model, which might have a couple of themes because they're so important and so well supported by the MAG here, but that we also leave flexibility and room for some things to, some themes to come up through the submissions and the proposals, and maybe do that through trying to work through a tagging methodology. We'll see where we come out on that today, but we need to have some fairly substantive direction around the sub-themes as well, again, in order to support the call for proposals. We should come back a little bit later and determine where we are around the work on the workshop proposals and the guidelines from the working group meeting early this morning. And I'm just checking my title and a discussion on the main sessions or the thematic sessions, but what we're referring to here are those big three-hour blocks of time. So with that, I know there was a lot of traffic on the mail list last night and this morning around the themes. I think I saw in the lunchroom quickly a number of groups sort of sitting together trying to discuss it, trying to look for consensus in the best way of the UN system. So I think at this point, it may make sense to open it up to the floor to look for some comments or positions on themes. And Virat, I think you've done some work to help introduce it and possibly to catalog them a little bit as well. So I see you have your flag up. I'm Somebody would like to kick off with that?
Thank you, Chair. I've got two slides for the MAC to look at. One is the last 10 years of overarching themes, which were read out yesterday, but it'll just help us to just take a two-minute view of what we have, if I can ask them to put it up, and then the consolidated list of what we have received so far by way of suggestions to say that whether we want to be consistent in continuity or consistent in not being continuous and different, those choices can be made, but I think it'll be helped to sort of see what we've done so far over the last decade. There's a third slide that does cluster broad sub-themes together just to see this is what it is, and we can decide not to do it or do it, and that's a different matter. I've sent three. So the first one is the one on overarching themes. No, we just sent it. Maybe you could send it to the, you could also send it to every MAG in case they want it as an email.
Sure, we can publish them.
Okay. So this is since 2006. The word internet governance has been used 6 times in red. The word development in one way or the other has been used 6 times. The word multi-stakeholder in one way or the other has been used on 2 occasions. Just spend a minute just looking at the journey over the last decade. So unless we're trying to memorize these, I can move it to the next slide. The next one is the consolidation. Do you have it?
Yeah, no, the other one has not arrived. Hmm. Sorry.
Okay. Sorry about that. It's a joint email to you, Chengatai, and Lynn. Send it 3 or 7. No?
It's okay. I will publish it now. Yes.
Chengatai, do you have it?
Yes. But he said he had it.
Okay, good. Yeah. Second. Sorry. No, not this one. These are broad sub-themes. There's another one, not this.
There's another one.
I know Brian had done what is well.
Yeah,
is it
could,
different
yeah,
from that? Or
it consolidates
if
that.
If we have the one Brian did. We can.
Where's his email?
The secretariat last night had pulled together a list of all the...
But it didn't arrive in the mail.
Just sent one, just now.
Okay.
Just have a look, just now.
It's not attached in the email, apparently. Sorry.
Okay, maybe we should work with Brian's list then.
Is yours there, Brian? Do you want to? If
it's titled recommendations for overarching themes.
Yeah, I've got it. I'll just
okay.
Put it on a stick. Oh, actually, I just got a mime drop. It wasn't attached.
Okay, send it again.
You always want to make sure volunteers who are active and contribute a lot feel fully supported. Gotcha. I have to say, Vera, we really do appreciate too all the efforts you put in all the times to help organize so much of the background materials here.
Thanks. Not yet?
Okay, I got you.
Yeah.
It's here, okay. I will publish it, okay?
Excellent. Sorry about this.
So maybe just a word of introduction. Brian had taken the kind of emerging themes from our meeting yesterday and some of the mails that were online as of probably prior to 9 o'clock this morning, and Chengatai sent that out to the MAG list. I think what's here is both Brian and Virat worked to incorporate some of the mail list traffic from the course of this morning, and I think probably tried to choose those that seem to be some sort of emerging consensus. I mean, the list is still quite long, but so that was the genesis of this slide that's in front of you now.
Yeah, this is the full list. It has a little bit of, well, if you look at the first two, you can tell it's ensuring that no one is left behind.
Sorry, Virat, where is the Juan's proposal? It's my proposal, a little bit transformed by Juan's.
Which is what? Which is?
It was on the list. Not there.
What was it?
Did you scroll down?
There are 18. There's only thing 10 here.
Oh, okay. Yeah, okay.
Which one is it? Can you tell
me? Yeah, it will be the, maybe there is.
Scroll down.
Yeah, it's 16, yeah. 16, 17, yeah. Okay, sorry.
No problem. And if anybody's missing, please do put it in, because I did my best to, and Brian and I tried to just look at emails to put this together, so something could be missing. Please do come in if yours is missing. I think yours is there. It's number 2 over there, right?
Mic for the speaker, please.
Well, I think what we should do with this is use it as kind of the current status of the discussions we've all had offline and in the room today. And I mean, I'd like to give this a little bit of time, but not much. I think we're quite close. I think the sub-theme discussions will help to round out the intent and what we're looking for in terms of proposals. But I'll open the floor here for any comments or reactions. What I wouldn't really like is a lot of sort of defense over every one of them, because I think most of them are fairly similar, and I just don't think that will move us forward. So the floor is open. I see Michael and Cheryl.
I'm not going to delve into the details of the different ideas, just to propose something, and that is that we do strive, as we pick up our overarching title and the sub-themes, to I guess I could use the verb market to the ministries and sectors outside of ICT. We've done a good job of attracting the ICT ministers, but internet governance has a huge impact on the economics ministry, on business development. There's also a research component. So I hope that we'll have some things in here that will catch the attention. And that goes to my second point, which is in our discussion about whether to do day zero on day zero or not, I think there was some confusion. Nobody was suggesting that ministers would stay for 4 days. I think the suggestion was that we have some of the opening ceremony at the start and some of the traditional day zero activity on day 4. One big advantage of that is that you could then perhaps get 2 or 3 ministers to come. Some would come at the start, some would come at the end. In the US, in Japan, in many countries, there's a real rivalry between different agencies who all think they have the lead on the digital economy. Give them 2 opportunities to come and maybe they'll both come.
Cheryl, you have the floor.
Thank you, Madam Chair. I think all of the themes would work very well. The one in particular that stands out for me is Internet for Inclusive Growth, however. And I just want to, I won't spend too much time, but just a couple seconds as to why. I think we're at a point now where we've just closed out 10 years. We were looking back there, and now we have 10 years ahead of us. And growth really is reflected in all the SDGs. And I think we've had agreement that, you know, we definitely want that to be the main focus of this particular meeting. But it pulls in economic growth, opportunities for people, connectivity, and it's very forward-looking. And so I think that that could be a very good one for this year. Although, as I said, all of them are great. We could, you know, I could defend any one of them for any reasons, but I just put that out there for discussion. Thank you.
I also think there was lots of support for Juan's concept of simple and elegant, and he's actually just put his flag up, and I think certainly that and a few of the others meet that criteria. Juan, you have the floor.
No, I'm not going to defend any, just to articulate some guidelines. Even though in the past we have not followed it strictly. But I have seen that when this is printed or displayed, it comes always, the main theme, after putting that the Internet Governance Forum and Guadalajara or whatever the year. So I would suggest not in the main theme itself not to repeat the words Internet and governance, just to put the main idea, whatever it is, because otherwise it's a little bit cumbersome to read Internet governance forums and then seeing again Internet governance for this or Internet for that, because it's already in the title. People already know that it's Internet and it is governance, and so I would just recommend that. And of course, I again say that it should be short. There are many proposals there that are short, so any could do, and wide enough that is not that it can cover everything. And another thing, you have to remember that nowadays everybody agrees that internet is not an end in itself. So I'd rather, and along the lines that that Mike said before, I think that we should not be technical in or put digital or things like that, because that is not an end in itself. Internet is a tool for something else. So maybe that we can put that in the sub-themes or in the paragraph that you say in the call for workshop. But in the main theme, we have to put, you know, a bigger aim, as was said, that this is the beginning of 10 years era, and so on, so on.
I'd just like to point out that I think one of the items that was missed here was Victor's suggestion, which is harnessing global disruptive transformation for sustainable development. I did speak to him before he was leaving, and you know, he appreciated the time to participate, but also said he was comfortable with the result of the title coming from this room. So we should make sure that it's considered and there, but know that he's given us his support. So any other kind of general reflections or comments on the list? And while I quickly in the background try and figure out how we might close this, I have Segun and Rasha and Omar. Segun, you have the floor, sorry.
Okay, thank you, Chair. Well, I just want to provide, I just wanted to contribute to one of the topic, the theme here, number nine, Internet governance and inclusive growth. If we were to go by the suggestion made by the last speaker, I will propose for enabling inclusive growth, simply like that.
Thank you, Segun. I do think that's a good suggestion as well. So next on the list was Rashad. I'd like to give the opportunity to those people that haven't actually participated too much, so I'll manage that HQ first, if I can.
Thank you, Chair. Actually, very very closely related to that and off of Hassam's suggestion, number 13 on the list, if we would take out internet governance, that would be inclusive growth, connecting the next billion, and protecting online freedoms. I would just really like to pitch online freedoms, because if we don't protect the freedoms of those already online and those we want to put online, then there's really no point of people being online.
Thank you. Thank you. Omar, you have the floor.
Thank you, Chair. In Afghanistan, one of our basic problem is the price of connectivity. It's about $300 per Mbps, and that's extremely expensive and unaffordable for the common Afghan. In Japan, it's less than half a dollar, I guess, for. In the U.S., it's about $5-$6 per Mbps. For an Afghan to pay $300 for one Mbps connection is crazy expensive, and they have other basic needs, so it's gonna be really difficult for us to connect to the internet. I see the list includes some really good ones like Leave No One Behind and Internet for Inclusive Growth, connecting the next billion. These are all good. And there are some other really interesting themes in there. But from the developing world's perspective, if we can focus more on connecting the next billion, because we are part of that. So Afghanistan is like 30 million population, and majority of the country is not connected. And if we can promote internet as a human right issue as well, that's going to be that will really help. And if IGF or in our meeting we can communicate to the governments like Afghanistan to reduce the cost of internet so it's affordable for the locals. So I really like the Leave No One Behind and Internet for Inclusive Growth. These are the two favorite ones for me.
Thank you, that was helpful. And if the speakers that are in the queue, if you do have a preference or you could begin to support or get behind the enabling inclusive growth, that would be a good indication here. So we had an online participant, and then Aida, you're in the queue.
Thank you very much. I've just been asked to read one comment in order to save the time. Deirdre Williams, I would like to see something about balance. And from Shita Lakshmi, following Juan's point and the necessity to include other government agencies and make internet an issue for all, I would like to support number 2 and 3. Thank you.
Thank you. Aida, you're next.
I would just like to emphasize that we had a lot of support through the mailing lists. I don't know if everyone are able to catch for the human rights, and I feel that Leave No One Behind really captures the idea of inclusiveness. So this would be for me.
Thank you. And Anya, let me just, Deirdre had her comment, which was read out, right? Is she looking for the cue again? Okay. We had Flavio, Elizabeth, and Virhat. Flavio, you have the floor.
Yeah. Thank you, Lynn. So I just like to give some arguments for proposal number 16, which is Juan's version of 17, which was proposed by myself. So if we just forget the Internet Governance Forum Guadalajara 2016, the title would be Building the Future We Want. It's simple, it's elegant, it's just two requirements, and very broad. I would like to remember that the 17 sustainable development goals are defined on top of three pillars, which are end poverty, protect the planet, and ensure prosperity for all. These are the terms in the United Nations site. And many of the proposals we have there do not cover all these three pillars. We have, if we take inclusive growth, for instance, it's more about ending poverty or ensuring prosperity, but not directly regarding protecting the planet. That's the same problem with other proposals that speak about human rights. Of course, all those things are very important, but they are not broad enough. And we should not take a main theme which forgets some important aspects of human development, of sustainable development. And the future we want, this is the title of the outcome document of the United Nations Conference on Sustainable Development held in 2011, which is built on this, upon these three pillars: ending poverty, protecting the planet, and ensuring prosperity for all. That's why we did this proposal.
Okay, no, and I appreciate
12, yeah.
Okay, thank you, Fabio. I appreciate your input. I'm not sure that I actually feel compelled to ensure that our title matches the Sustainable Development Goals in full. I'd rather it really reflected internet governance and the Internet Governance Forum and our aspirations here for the next 10 years, fully recognizing that there's a strong link between the SDGs and our work, but that there's not a 100% overlap. But that was just the chair's prerogative of jumping the queue. The next was Elizabeth.
Thank you, Chair, and I will be quick. I wanted to support actually the statement that the chair just made in terms of not repeating entirely the buzzwords or phrases from other initiatives. I think it's nice if we can roll those themes and ideas into the contextual. The contextual paragraph or whatever that we thought we envisioned for this. I think there are a lot of ideas that will not be captured by one overarching theme explicitly, and so that paragraph could serve very well that way. And so I would like to lend my support to the idea of enabling inclusive growth. That recommendation sounds good to me.
Okay, thank you, Elizabeth. Virat, you're next, and then Salah.
Two very short comments. One, the one thing we need to bear in mind is that this is an unusual year where the workshop proposers will take their clue from the title. It almost never happens. Workshop proposals never take the cue from the main title. They normally take it from sub-themes. In the event we don't have sub-themes, this is all they have to go with. So as we pick our title or our theme, keep in mind that there are some 200 people who will submit proposals being guided by this and the paragraph that you said. They will not have subtitles to fall back upon. The only compromise that I would offer, because the comment made about the fact that growth doesn't offer everything, usually the words growth and development go together. There has also been a lot of emphasis this morning since yesterday on sustainable development, which may not sort of all fit in here, and I think the host country also has that in their proposition. I'm sorry, it wasn't caught here, it was verbally said. This is all the written comments. The only sort of compromise I would sort of offer, if that works for everybody, is to say internet for enabling inclusive growth and development. Usually the words growth and development go together, and there's a reason for it, because one doesn't mean the other, and kind of it, when put together, they're more comprehensive. But I'm okay with one or the other.
Okay, thank you, Virat. Salah, you have the floor.
Thank you, Madam Chair. I'd just like to support Omar's what Omar shared in terms of the context in Afghanistan, to say that in Kiribati, they have to pay $2 Australian to access the internet for 30 minutes. And from the brief survey that was run prior to coming here, noting that we will be discussing themes, top on the agenda from all of the mailing lists is bridging the digital divide. However, having sat here over the past few days, notably, I've heard from my colleagues in Europe, because I took the time to ask the Uralo chair what the sentiments were in Europe, and he said cybersecurity is something important to them. And so in terms of themes, Chair, I would like to support either connecting the next billion or leave no one behind. For this simple reason, it captures the following in terms of accessibility, availability, and affordability issues that were raised by Oman and a few others from the emerging world, issues of interconnection, infrastructure, e-commerce, trade. It captures inclusion in terms of gender, whether it's men, women, transgender, youth, children, elderly, geographical diversity, or persons with disabilities. It captures security, stability, and resiliency in terms of cybersecurity, IPv6, sustainability of IXPs, disaster response reduction, critical information infrastructure protection. It captures multilingualism in terms of IDNs, using the internet to preserve language, example in the case of the Catalan community in Europe. In terms of human rights, it captures civil, political, economic, social, cultural rights pertaining to the various human rights conventions. In terms of meaningful participation, participation from underserved communities and those from marginalized territories. In terms of sharing knowledge, we've heard over the last few days the need for observatories and knowledge hubs and the need for accelerated growth and partnership. And also we've heard from Silicon Valley, innovation, disruptors. It captures showcasing how ICT and internet is transforming communities. But more importantly, Madam Chair, why I would like to reinforce my support for this too is this. If you look at the phrase, leave no one behind, underpinned behind it is a philosophy of collaboration, of the extension of working together. So that was all, Madam Chair.
Thank you, Sala. We have quite a long queue here. I'd like to give this discussion about 15 minutes more maximum. So I would just ask people to be brief and really if you can highlight sort of your support. I don't think we need a lot of background. I think it's pretty clear, but I'm just trying to get a sense of the room in terms of where there's any emerging consensus. So Zina, you have the room or the floor.
Thank you. Actually, I sent a suggestion this morning for an overarching theme, but I don't see it in the list. That's why I just want to mention it in case you find it suitable for this IGF. Taking into consideration the humanitarian crisis almost everywhere happening in this world, I think we should highlight fair and decent living. So I suggest internet governance for fair and decent living. Thank you.
Thank you, Zina. Hossam, I think you were next in the queue.
I don't know if I have the right to defend my case or not. So if not, I can stop.
Could start with a quick preference indication.
Okay, I would go for the adjusted one, which is internet enabling inclusive growth, and simply, many governments in the developing world are really concerned about fair distribution of welfare, whether social, economic, political, etc. So it answers all of that once we can see how internet would be able to enable fair distribution and inclusive growth. Thank you.
Thank you, Hassan. Murad, you have the floor.
Thank you, Chair. Would like to be brief, support Sigun's comments on IG and enabling inclusive growth. And also the issue raised by Omar, which is not particular to LDCs, but also even in middle-income developing countries for several reasons. As you mentioned, there are many similarities between the themes proposed. So as we used to ask the workshop proposers to merge their proposals, we should do the same, I guess, in our group by reducing the number of themes listed in the paper as a first step before adopting the final overarching theme. Thank you.
Thank you. Miguel, you have the floor.
Sure. I'd like to support number 11, but I'd like to add the word sustainable and inclusive growth. Maybe it would be a broader impact there.
Okay, thank you, Miguel. Juan, you have the floor.
Yes, after listening to the previous intervention, and especially your words, Chair, that for me are orders, that we need to contextualize this thing,
I have a new proposal. Nobody believes that.
But before saying the proposal, I will say again that I think all these specific things that are being proposed lately, like the growth, that is the economic part, like the freedom of expression, that is part of the human rights, those are important but are aspects of maybe that's good for the sub-themes. For the main theme, we need something that covers everything. So my proposal, if somebody can type it as I say it, Luis, can you type it?
If we go if we go back to the transcription for a moment, well, you can see it there, I guess, it's probably. That's a PDF,
or
I think.
Here, it's very simple. Leaving no one behind the information society. It's part, everybody will recollect, we have the Information Society Plus 10 Summit last year. That's our context, and leaving no one behind. It's as Sala explained, it has all these connotations. And in the paragraph that goes below, then we can say that covers the Connect the Next Billion, it can cover the sustainable growth and inclusive growth. It can contain, and we can all explain that below. But for that, I repeat, leaving no one behind the information society. That's my proposal. Thank you.
Getting some support while going away from the short and elegant. But so did the Segun's as well, which was the enabling inclusive growth. So let me just leave those two table on the moment. I mean, Juan, I'm not sure you heard, but I think there's... So we've got leaving no one behind. The Information Society, or a little bit of wordsmithing there happening in real time. We've got Segun's proposal, which was getting quite a bit of traction here in the room, which was, and obviously these are preceded by the Internet Governance Forum, it was enabling inclusive growth. I said there's another six or seven people in the queue. I'd like to go through them quickly, if they can, and they can sort of signal whether or not they're supportive of one or the other. We'll see if we can bring this to a close. And I'm very happy to say now that we have someone that we haven't heard from before in the queue, and that's Xiaodong. So Xiaodong, you have the floor.
Thank you, Madam Chair. I think if I can do some combination between the number 2 and number 12, I will support that. I think if we recall the memory for the past 10 years, four times to remain to mention the developing, and three times to mention the sustainable development. So I think in the past 10 years, development is a main topic. But I think it's because this year is the first year for the next 10 years. So I think it's very good we discuss how to connect the next billion. I think we try to make sure the internet can benefit everyone, but we cannot assume everybody wants to connect the internet. So if we say that don't let one behind the information society, I think you cannot assume everybody wants to connect that. Thank you.
Thank you, Xiaodong. Bojano, apologies, pronunciation. You have the floor.
Okay, thank you. It was said that it has to be, there is a engineering of the internet governance and also toward the prosperous world. That's why I propose number 18, engineering internet governance for a prosperous world, or maybe just like internet governance toward a prosperous world like that. Thank you.
Thank you. Just continuing through the list here, Izumi.
Thank you, Madam Chair. So in principle, I think I agree with previous comments being made that this is not like a since this is an overarching theme, we shouldn't be too focused on like one particular element of the issue, but should be able to accommodate several different themes. So based on this thinking, I have a preference on enabling inclusive growth, because it has the aspect of covering the issue of access, digital divide, but also the economic aspect of it. And I think leaving no one behind the from the information society, I based on the same principle, I am also fine with that. So these are the two preferences that I have. Thank you.
Thank you, Izumi. We have a few online participants. Jack, I think.
Thank you. I've been asked to read three comments on behalf of three members. From Sylvia Monzon de Bedard, a mix between 11 and 6, Internet for Inclusive Growth and Knowledge. From Sumon Ahmed Sabir, as we are talking about Internet of Things, sometimes called Internet of Everything, which is really going to impact use of Internet in a big way, along with the cybersecurity and freedom of speech also becoming a challenge. So my choice will be a mixture of 11 and 13. That is Internet for Inclusive Growth, connecting the next billion and protecting online freedom. From Jack Key, sustainable development and human rights are linked. Human rights is not only about civil and political rights, but also about economic justice, social and cultural rights. Human rights is a broad framework that should encompass the broad spectrum of all aspects of life. And since workshop proposals are also very supportive of human rights, as shown in previous years, I would reaffirm my support for human rights stated in the main theme. Now, if you allow, Cedric from UNESCO would like to intervene. Cedric, you have the floor.
Hello, everyone. This is Cedric Bachholz from UNESCO. I would like to say a few words on different topics proposed. On the enabling inclusive growth, I see very well what Izumi is saying on the universal access and economic dimension, but I go with Jack that that would not be sufficient. We really need to include the social, the human rights dimension stronger in the title, to leave it open to all kinds of the different workshops as it stands. So the different proposals made, one by Juan Fernandez, would be very inclusive. And I would just propose to transform it into, to transform the part of leaving no one behind for inclusive knowledge societies. Why is that? Because knowledge societies is actually the term which is being used in the adopted SDG text in the 2030 agenda, and it is more inclusive because we want to include dimensions of culture and not only the hardware connectivity and access parts many of us are dealing with, but also the other dimensions which are more inclusively reflected in the knowledge society's concept quoted in the SDGs. So that would be my proposal, building on what Juan Fernandez explained. Thank you.
Thank you very much. Ginger Peck is asking to take a note that she is emphasizing her support for human rights theme, so what was proposed by Jack. Thank you.
Thank you. We've got sort of 9 people in the queue. It ends with Herman, and I'm going to stop that. I really would like everybody's comments to be quite short, express a preference, and if you feel the need to actually add some context, please do be as brief as you can so we can continue on with the rest of the agenda. So, Wisdom, you were in the queue.
Thank you, Madam Chair. Looking at the United Nations Sustainable Development Summit, I think there were dialogue, about 6 dialogue. And then the first one is ending poverty and hunger. And then the second one is tackling inequalities, empowering women and girls, and leaving no one behind. Then the third one, fostering sustainable economic growth and transforming and promoting sustainable consumption and production. The fourth one, protecting our planet and combating climate change. The fifth one, building effective, accountable, and inclusive institutions. Then the last one, strengthen global partnership for realizing the post-2015 development agenda. I think with this six dialogue, they connect with number 11, which is Internet for Inclusive Growth. But then I'll like modification on that, on the internet part, and I'll add my voice to what Segum said. We should add, we should just remove the internet and then replace that with the enabling inclusive growth.
Thank you, Wisdom. Liesl, you have the floor.
Thank you, Chair. I just wanted to come in after Cedric from UNESCO, because his proposal was very close to the one that we had put forward on knowledge, fostering knowledge and forging connections. So I'd support the Knowledge Society approach that he took in his intervention. I'd also want to support the comments that have been made about being as broad as we can to encompass all of the issues that we may find ourselves talking about in the IGF, and so I echo those comments and just add that I think where we're going with the either writing a paragraph or having some themes, you know, will not leave. I think we can find ways to not leave our workshop proposers without some context, even if we provide a broad theme. And then I suppose I have to be a little bit funny and be compelled to say that while I love the idea of leave no one behind, it's a very American thing to say, and I apologize for that, but we have had a presidential a policy in the past of leave no child behind. And while I'm happy to move past that, I just feel like I had to mention it for everybody's humor, perhaps.
And what about those who want to be left behind?
Well, then I suppose it's their human right to do so. having supported Cedric's intervention, I can also support enabling inclusive growth as another option. Thank you.
Thank you. Thank you, Liesl. Raphael, you have the floor.
Thank you, Chair. I will be brief. I am very much okay with Huham's proposal, as amended by I guess it was Cedric from UNESCO. But I am a bit reluctant to convey a message expressed in negative terms. So I would like to propose what we put it in positive, like something like taking everybody on board the knowledge society, so that that addresses Lisa's concern as well. Thank you.
Thank you, Raphael. Cheryl, you have the floor.
Thank you, Madam Chair. I actually was going to say in part what Liesl said. It is the no person left behind is very much kind of an American catchphrase. I do support Segun's inclusion and growth, you know, some version of that. And I just wanted to say, I agree with all the comments that have been made with respect to how important human rights and some other certain issues are. And I think this is why sometimes the sub-themes are helpful, because then you have, you know, even if you don't have exactly, you know, underneath the main theme, some of the wording that you think might attract certain proposals, the sub-themes can kind of help to drive that. So thank you.
I think that's a good comment too on the sub-themes. No, I don't know. Julian. Having a hard time reading. Julian, you have the floor.
Thank you, Madam Chair. I think that based on the discussions and that has been online, I believe that leave no one behind. It's a good proposal from Sala, and also Yeah, the number three is related to human rights and combination. It's representing the work we have been doing in getting more people benefit from the use of the internet. So I would like to support internet governance and human rights. Leave no one behind.
Thank you, Julian. And Alejandra, you have the floor.
Thank you, Madam Chair. It's to support Juan's proposal, but now I'm listening this thing about the phrase, so I'm doubting. And I think the number 17, the Flavio's proposal, is a good one too.
Thank you very much. To drive further on Juan's proposal, but also to rethink the metaphor, because I think that the metaphor of a train or a ship or something traveling is constantly used, and it's not necessarily a good one, because we're talking about a society, and that's usually a community. And to connect to my this morning's intervention, that I do think that the future might produce a lot more walled communities. So perhaps leaving no one outside the information society could be another way of thinking about it, because I think that there, if it is a society, then it's a space. A connection of the two competing things, the competing ideas, could be, but more complex, inclusive growth that leaves no one outside the information society. And a third, but very simple one, would be all connected and included. Thanks.
Thank you, Jivan. Next is Segun.
Well, thank you, Madam Chair. I really would like to consider leave no one behind. But from the perspective of addressing critical information infrastructure and the security and all that, I find it difficult to agree that that topic will address it or it will be inclusive of that. Inasmuch as I don't want to be saying that I'm pushing what I have recommended earlier, but I believe that inclusive growth is more generic. It's actually inclusive of all that we've been talking about. Most of these things that we're talking can come in under the sub-theme. Then if you have a comprehensive synopsis that could help us to capture most of these other topics we're talking about, I think we will get it in a better perspective. Thank you.
Thank you, Segun. Next we have Mike, and then over there.
I'll be very brief, because I'm going to talk about being very brief. There's a great book that I've recommended before called Micro Style, The Art of Writing Little. It's 80 pages long by a linguist, and it's all about how to write titles and bumper stickers and sound bites and PowerPoint bullet points. Having listened to the discussion, it seems to me that enabling inclusive growth is a very effective way to provide that quick buzzword, four syllables, inclusive growth, that people will talk about. It's also a very timely topic, since for the last year and a half, there's been a huge discussion, in at least in the US and Europe, about income inequality. I just think that the shorter the better, and in the end, if you've got four syllables. Juan's idea is nice, but we're hearing a lot of problems. One of the problems is that leave no one behind is a cliche. It's been around for too long. We might be able to turn it into leave no one offline, which is a nice twist. But I really don't think there's going to be a way to add information society or knowledge society or net society, because those are very amorphous terms, and they extend a lot further than the internet. When you say knowledge society, that usually includes brick and mortar libraries full of books, includes newspapers. It's not just about the digital world. So I come to the conclusion that enabling inclusive growth is probably the one that works best.
Thank you, Michael. I think we're getting down to the last four or five here. I have Makan and then Cisse. Makan, you have the floor.
Makan Fay. Yes, I would concur with Cedric from UNESCO that we should be speaking now about knowledge societies, because in the outcome document of the high-level meeting in December, it's clearly indicated we're not to the ambition to move beyond information societies to knowledge societies. I think we should take into account that sentence from the high-level meeting in of the General Assembly in December. In this connection, I support number 24.
Thank you, Makan. Cisse?
Thank you, Madam Chair. Cisse Khan from African Civil Society. I fully agree with Makan about knowledge society. And also, where can we put multilingualism and local contents? Because if you say one of the biggest barrier of access to internet is one, literacy, and then also not speaking that language at all. And also, I have a concern with leaving no one behind. Shall we include terrorists? I don't agree with this formula, because if everybody is inside, then we have to be sure that it's used in a proper and responsible way, so that people that are not using it in a proper and responsible way are outside. That's my point. Thank you.
Thank you, Cisse. Ilya, you have the floor.
Thank you, Madam Chair. I would like to support number 11 with the edit Internet Enabling Inclusive Growth, because for me it's simple and understandable as a non-native English speaker. And I think that if we go for something more complicated, it may be not so easy to translate in all parts of the world. I have this as personal experience with Eurodic. We were unable to make the best translation of the topic to Bulgarian. Thank you.
Okay. Thank you, Ilya. I think we have one online. Is it Amelia? No, we still have in the room too, but I have the online. Please go ahead, Anya.
I'm going to read, we received an email from Amelia Andersdotter. Honorable Chair, colleagues of the MEG, in the past 2 years, human rights in online environments have risen to the top of the United Nations agenda through the diligent work of many special rapporteurs, and not to mention the General Assembly. Human rights have also been part of the IGF agenda, although in a less prominent position. I want to voice my support for changing this. If the IGF is a place where stakeholders get together to discuss issues of import to internet governance, it seems clear to me that the impact of nation-state legislation on technical infrastructure, as was emphasized by the United Nations High Representative of Human Rights in their report on digital rights of June 30, 2014, is part of that governance. For if internet governance does not concern technical infrastructure, what does it govern? I would like to bring the attention of the Chair and of my colleagues to ongoing efforts at both of the IETF and the W3C to have better human rights assessments of proposed standards. This is a positive development and will balance power and equity between the world's nations, both in economical and political terms. Not to mention the advantageous effects for individuals. For this reason, the IGF should strive to be at the forefront of these discussions and not leave just them for other forums to deal with. It is my belief that the IGF brings a legitimacy to the discussion it would not otherwise have. In order to safeguard this legitimacy, let's make human rights a main theme. Thank you.
Thank you, Amelia. I have just two more speakers, and then I am going to go to Juan, since his proposal has gotten some discussion, and then I'm actually going to put a proposal from the chair to the floor. So we have Christine,
I'm from Egypt, and Herman. And Juan, you'll be the...
Cristina Arida from Egypt, for the record. I would like to go with enabling inclusive growth, and I think inclusive is probably the same as leaving no one behind, so it's probably the same, it gives the same meaning, and I think the word of growth is an addition. So if we just say leave no one behind, we may be including others that we don't really think should be included with the norms that they're included with, so with the reference that we put. So I think enabling inclusive growth is additional, but maybe we can add sustainable, so maybe we can add enabling inclusive and sustainable growth. Thank you.
Thank you, Christine. Herman?
Thank you, Madam Chair. Very briefly, I'd like to support the theme number 17. It may be a combination with the 16. This is Flavio's proposal. I think is aligned with the recent mandate of the IGF. We need to focus on the future. It has a broad concept, which I think is important for our overarching team. And in addition to that, if I am allowed to say, I do not support anything related to leave no one behind. I'm a big fan of the American war movies. One of the most common rhetoric they use is that phrase. And it was the first click it made me in my head when I read it, even though it was linked with the Sustainable Development Goals. So that's it. Thank you.
Thank you, Herman. Juan, and then Yolanda's actually been in touch with Victor, so
thank you,
we
Chair.
Have...
I'm not going to defend a particular proposal, but I'm going to say that what we're doing here. This is a marketing exercise. Are somebody from marketing here?
Could we have a mic with the speaker, please? Thank you.
Technical guy, what you said before. Technical guy. I think that next MAC, we need marketing people here, because let me explain a little bit as an example. It's not that I am defending this, but as an example. We need here phrases. This is not a technical or an academic discussion. First of all, let me establish that this discussion of, and you that are in the United Nations knows that, even you are young, this discussion of the UNESCO defending knowledge society and ITU, in those days, Information Society. This is a 20-year-old battle. But unfortunately for UNESCO, what has prevailed in the document is the Information Society. We had a World Summit in Information Society. Is one not a World Summit in Knowledge Society? So we have to have that, so people that lead these leaders can identify, because we had the summit last December of World Summit of Information Society plus 10. What I'm saying is that this is referenced, that we are not hearing in academic. Maybe I agree, technically, that it should be knowledge, but this is a marketing thing. And the other thing behind phrases like leaving no one behind or a future we want, how was the future we want, those are phrases that has the linkage with the sustainable developing goals. For instance, the leaving no one behind is the title, is the subtitle of the book that came out, you know, that has the introduction of the Secretary General of the United Nations, that is called Global Developing Goals, leaving no one behind. It's not the concept that we are defending here, that we're going to have everybody in or that. It's just the reference. Because as we said before, and that we want to be in that movement. So it's the reference. It's not that it should be this or that. Just that people read there and they identify, oh, this has to do with the development goals. And the Information Society is the context that the chairman asked that we contextualize in this. I could be happy by many of those. I could be happy for leaving no one behind, connecting the next billion, although it's clear what we mean by connecting the next billion, but it doesn't have a reference to a global agreement in the world, but it could be fine. It could be fine. I'm not for inclusive growth, not because I don't like inclusive growth, but because it will need explanation, because it's not evident what we're talking about when we talk of inclusive growth. It's not evident. Of course, we all know that we are not want to be taller, that we want to have economic growth. But that could be in the paragraph that you say inside. By the way, I remember you all, I said it many times in previous MAG meetings, that sustainable development is a concept, that it's already been conceptualized, that has three pillars. It has the pillar, social pillar, in which you have to be development with social inclusiveness, with human rights, with all that. It has, of course, the economic pillar. It has to be sustainably economically, because otherwise it doesn't sustain. And it has the third pillar that has to be environmentally. Maybe we could create that, but when you talk about sustainability, is that. So what I'm saying, that this is a marketing, because if we go tinkering with one word or the other, I think that will lead us nowhere. We need to have phrases that makes reference to what's going on in the world. And unfortunately, that was not our choice. It was choice, this leaving no one behind. There's another that is the future we want. It's another of those catchphrases that are aligned with the sustainable developing agenda for 30 years, for 2030. Those are the phrases. And in our area, the phrase that everybody understands is information society, because we had two summits and we have here now the high level event of plus 10. That's why I say just in this case, but in any case, I'm happy with anyone, but not to be very convoluted, because then it will be something that we understand, but as somebody say here, I will need to write a glossary when I bring back to my country to explain what we meant there. And I think that's not the idea. We have to sell. And for that, we need marketing people. Maybe for the next MAG, we need more marketing people.
Thank you, Juan. I had said a moment ago that I was going to close the queue and then go to, and Miguel, I think your flag's just still up because you spoke earlier, right? Okay, you have a short one. I thought. Please go ahead. I thought your flag was left up from earlier.
No, I think if we're speaking about marketing, sustainable is, I think, one of the most marketed words in the last years. So adding the word sustainable to what was the internet? Sustainable and inclusive work would work.
When I listened to the comments here in the room, I actually heard a couple of things, and an awful lot of support from a variety of stakeholders and geographies and countries across the room here for enabling inclusive growth, or maybe enabling inclusive and sustainable growth. I think when we start adding human rights and freedoms as sub, we're making it long, and I really liked Juan's earlier comments of short and elegant. I think some of those are very important themes, and as Cheryl said, can perhaps better be addressed and called out for more attention through sub-themes, and we will do a paragraph or two or some additional context. So my proposal was going to be Internet Governance Forum, enabling inclusive growth. As I was coming to that conclusion, Johan reached over and said she's been in touch with Victor, and he's been following some of the themes and the discussions online, and he actually had sort of a preference. And Yolanda's actually going to share his rationale and his preference now.
Thank you, Cher. Yes, Victor has been following the discussions, and I think one comment that he made, and I think is important for the reflection that we're having this afternoon, is that even though information society is a very important theme, it's a theme and a topic that we understand, all of us. But when you go back home, and when you try to invite ministers or VIPs for the different stakeholders groups, either private sector, academia, civil society, technical community, and us in government, it's hard to explain what is information society. It is our daily days life, right? But for not all stakeholders, VIPs. So we think that in combination with internet governance, something that gather, I will say, all of the comments just exchanged before is enabling inclusive and sustainable growth. And I will emphasize inclusive and sustainable because of the Sustainable Development Goals and the 2030 Agenda, and because those are terms that are more inclusive of other areas besides just internet or information or knowledge society, which are terms that are very important but only common to a very few stakeholders that on our day-to-day basis handling those topics. Thank you, Chair.
So I'd like to put forward enabling inclusive and sustainable growth as the title for IGF 2016. Supported. The Internet Governance Forum enabling inclusive and sustainable growth. So I want to thank everybody for doing that. And I think we can, this is probably the fastest the MAG has ever come to agreement on a title. It still doesn't, you know, perhaps feel as, you know, efficient as it might. And any discussions on how we might improve some of these processes would be helpful. Juan, is it a short comment? Because I'm really
just short comment, because it's based on what I said before. Why instead of growth world, including a sustainable world, because growth, it's narrow.
I had at least 20 people here in the room that were supportive of growth, and I think
one also of the catchphrases of the Sustainable Development Goals is. A sustainable world is one of the like that. So if you have inclusive and sustainable, because growth, it's only economic growth. And
I think
what,
with them
growth we're talking about.
As a room, we've had great support for growth. It's been on the table for a while. You were instrumental in getting us to short and elegant, and appreciate your help in keeping us there. Thank you very much, everybody. I think that's actually a really good and aspirational goal as well for the next 10 years. So we have two sort of more substantive. Juan Jandier. We have two fairly substantive items in front of us. One is a discussion on sub-themes. We need to advance that to a degree that would at least allow us to get the call for proposals out. And I think we should also do a sort of a session on the main sessions or the thematic sessions. And by that, I'm referring to these three-hour blocks. I actually think that could be quite a straightforward discussion in terms of the discussions we've had here over the last 3 days. And we have to come back at some point and determine whether or not we're ready to go forward on the workshop proposals and guidelines, the work from the working group this morning, which has that actually been sent out to the MAG yet?
Yes, I should have.
So Chengatai says Susan had, in fact, gone back and edited the documents and sent them out. And Chengatai says those documents have gone out to the MAG. So I don't want people to take away from the next discussions, but I would like to close on those later on today if we can as well. So sub-themes. We've had, I think, two high-level proposals. One is we get to a relatively small number of sub-themes. I don't think we've ever had more than six, and quite often we've had sort of four or five. And we try and define those today on the basis of obviously some very key topics that have come up through the course of the 2 days, and in fact some of them through this discussion on themes. Or the other proposal that seemed to be gathering some support from the room was to establish a couple of sub-themes and maybe leave a couple open that would come up through, I think, what was called sort of an induction process, but basically a process that would, again, through a couple of paragraphs in the call for proposals, give some guidance to the overall proposals, but allow the proposers to tag their proposals and committee would actually review those and basically look for where there was some support and aggregation, and I guess a reasonable, nice mix of proposals as well. I will comment that doing that, changes the, I think, the rating and the work of the MAG a little bit. I think we just need to take that into account because we're, frankly, I think thinking this process through while we're flying the plane, to use perhaps a bad analogy. But those are the two that I heard, was either we try and push through for an agreed smallish number of sub-themes, or we push through for a few and leave some flexibility for the others to arise through the process. So with that, I will open the floor for comments either at a process level or hopefully precise, short submissions on possible sub-themes. So the floor is open. Flavio?
Thank you, Lynn. In fact, yesterday there was a kind of third proposal, high-level proposal besides the two you have mentioned, is that we leave completely open the list of sub-themes, but instead we allow the workshop proposers to tag their proposals with up to three or four tags, stating which would be the sub-themes they think this, and we can give some guidance. For instance, having a list, an open-ended list of 30, 40 sub-themes, we can draw this from the previous IGF editions, or we can start with this list and then give a few days to the MAG members to add other topics they think are missing in this list. So this would be a list of 20, 30 sub-themes or even more. And then the workshop proposers would tag their proposals with these sub-themes. It would not be really sub-themes. It would be a long list of possible tags.
Okay, thank you, Flavio. Laura, you have the floor.
Thank you, Chair. I wanted to just come in on this discussion and link back to something that was in the session before, well, one of the morning sessions before lunchtime when we were talking around the dynamic coalitions. Mike Nelson raised the suggestion for having a dynamic coalition on corruption or working against corruption. I think that's, I think that shows how we can't be too prescriptive. New issues are coming up all the time, and I think if we try and nail down the sub-themes too much, we risk stifling some innovation and some bottom-up suggestions coming through from workshop proposers.
Thank you, Laura. Virat, you're in the queue.
So there is one slide that Senator Lewis, if you could put that. This is the one that sort of gives us an idea. If you wish to work with, rather than sub-themes, work with clusters, that does not suppress innovation and yet allows. The comment that I want to make is, if you say, please tag yourself to a sub-theme without giving a list, then lots of new first-timers will give us just, so what the secretary will have at the end of that is 150 sub-themes that people will invent. It will then become a little difficult to bring it together and run with this. I mean, they'll need extra time. We can go with that approach, nothing wrong, but here is if you can just see this on the cluster, this is a collection of, Lewis, could I ask you to get that slide? This is a collection of clusters of sub-themes over the last 10 years, including this IGF and everything that sort of has been thought about in broad terms. It's not perfect, but we just collected this mostly using information that Flavio had posted and then some more research based on what is there currently.
Vera, can I just ask for a clarification? And there isn't anyone else in the queue. I think you're suggesting perhaps a variation on what Flavio said, which is rather than giving a fairly sizable list of possible tags, that you would actually give a set of clustered sub-themes.
If you were to in fact give out a guidance, then it might make sense to give these very broad sub-themes under which several of them appear. Luis, do you have that slide? No.
I think you're talking.
No,
about
the one you showed earlier. Yeah. Remember? You showed that earlier. You'd showed that earlier.
I think he's, yes.
No.
Not this one?
No, the one you showed after this.
You mean the discussion again?
There's another one.
It was the one you showed when.
The one you'd showed when you, after this you'd shown that, and then we said not this. It's with you.
Okay, yeah.
Thank you, Lewis.
Sorry about this.
Maybe.
We can take other comments in the meantime if you want.
Well, so yes, Aubrey, please. I mean, take your time, Lewis. That's fine. Aubrey is in the queue as an online participant, so we'll go to Aubrey and then.
Thanks. This is Aubrey speaking. I want to thank Flavio for bringing up the idea of allowing the themes to emerge. I can actually, though, even though I haven't seen the picture, I could actually support the notion of including a picture of here's the themes that we have been through the previous 10 years, pick one of these or contribute your own as a way of allowing that emergence with guidance. But I still think it's very important for us to bring some part of this planning back into a bottom-up methodology that allows those that are going to be contributing the workshops, which to my mind, and I don't think I'm alone, is one of the most important parts of the dialogue that is the IGF, and to put that in the hands of those that make the recommendations. We've also talked about having webinars, and we've talked about perhaps coming up with methods for helping, you know, proposal writers who may want a little bit of assistance in doing it right. So that becomes, again, something that can help them. But I'd really like to ask people to seriously consider letting us have some bottom-up emergence on the themes. Perhaps it's bottom-up with guidance, but bottom-up. Thank you.
Thank you, Aubrey. And why don't I put that question to the room? So rather than talking about the modalities or how we might or might not support some flexibility in the sub-themes, are people generally happy with some portion of, it sounds like some portion of sub-themes perhaps being, let me rephrase this, are we happy allowing flexibility, whether it's 100% flexibility on the themes or it's one or two sub-themes and some other themes? There's no contrary opinions that say we should be extremely prescriptive and define all the sub-themes in the room? Okay, just to take that off the table. Makan, is it to that point?
Yes.
Okay, go ahead.
Thank you, Chair. Makan Fai. I believe it will be very difficult to leave it open, because if we leave it open, well, we'll end up with having maybe 1,000 sub-themes. Because workshop proposers, if you base ourselves on workshop proposers, they just come on there with their own interest, and I think we should go back to what we have been doing, giving sub-themes. At least we give a cluster of sub-themes and see if people can fit in, it's fine. If they cannot fit, if they bring something which the MAC thinks it is okay, then they can adopt it. Thank you.
Thank you, Makan. Would you support a hybrid? Would you support a hybrid, leaving some flexibility and some specificity to sub-themes?
Well, the MAC was appointed to deal with these issues. I would really prefer to be prescriptive.
Okay. Juan, you have the floor.
Yes, Chair. I realize that you are in sort of a conundrum here, because as I said before in some other meetings, we, the MAC, are a wedding planner. We are actually, that's our job. Our job is to plan the whole wedding, from the hors d'oeuvres to the drinks, and even the selection of the orchestra. When we select the orchestra, we put the music, but we cannot know how the participant will dance to that music. So I think that what you're saying as a hybrid, I think it's the solution, because what Avery just said has a lot of merit, because nobody here can say that we can exhaust all the subjects. There will be always somebody that will surprise us and will propose a workshop in a theme that we didn't foresee. And when we see it, said, oh, yes, it's important. So we should be open to that. On the other hand, as good wedding planners, we need some order in the party. So maybe there are some themes that we already can agree that, because they're relevant, I think the chairman, the co-chair, Victor, mentioned cybersecurity himself. Maybe that's one, because it's very relevant and very actual, or maybe some other that we should, in a way, suggest. But I think that the way out of this is not to have a list, but to have a sort of a paragraph in the call for workshops, a paragraph in which we say we encourage as you said, to put the context. This is the year, as you mentioned, the climate change of the world, the sustainable development, to put that. And we encourage the submission of workshop that address these topics, whatever, and includes something important such as, and we can put civil security. And it's an open list, so some people can include. To put it like that in a paragraph, not in a list like that, because when you list it like it's in the screen now, it seems to be exhausting, you know, that is that and nothing else. But if you put it in a paragraph in good redaction, then you can leave open to that. That's what I think it could be the solution to this.
Okay, thank you. That's helpful. And we can certainly obviously provide more context. I want to come back to Vera now to explain the chart here, because I think that might point to a methodology that hopefully bridges the differing views here. And then we'll go back to the rest of the queue.
So these are the cluster of themes that have been collected over the last 10 years, including workshop that have been submitted. So these are over 1,000 workshops, perhaps. And these are the broad themes under which we've been suggested. If there are new ideas, we could either leave it under emerging issues and the people can sort of put it out there. It says others, and sort of so in terms of new ideas, things that are now coming up which may not have anticipated, you can leave it under emerging issues. The reason, Chair, I'm suggesting clusters and not sort of specific sub-themes. By the way, in previous IGFs, surveillance has been a sub-theme. Legal and other framework has been a sub-theme. Enhancing digital trust has been a sub-theme. We're not suggesting that. We're putting them under these main headers. We can reduce them from six even down to, let's say, four. The reason why this is being suggested is the following. Apart from the fact that the guidance is required by the workshop proposal submitters, the program of the IGF, when printed on the website, color codes themes. People decide which workshops they want to attend based on the color codes. Because remember, at any given point in time, 10 parallel workshops are going on. So the choices that a person makes when he gets into the IGF pavilions is, I want to go and listen to issues of critical internet resources. All of them are tagged in pink color. Then they don't have to read all 10 parallel sessions. Remember, there are 10 parallel sessions running. So then a delegate must read the details of every single workshop listed between, say, 3:30 and 4 o'clock to understand which room he needs to be in. So this is all. Now we can avoid this, go with an open process, then the task will fall upon the secretariat to bring these 100 or 200 or 400 proposals into the themes, because in the end, the program and the agenda has to be color-coded. And I think Chengatai can explain that a little bit. So it's not so much only about what the workshop providers do, it's also about what they need to output in the final program. And I'm trying to link these two and therefore provide clusters, and we can change these or, and that's all. I mean, I have no preference for one or the other, just providing an input.
Okay. Thank you, Virat. We had Cheryl in the queue next. Cheryl, you have the floor.
Thank you, Madam Chair. I do support a hybrid approach, and I do take note of McCune's comment regarding what happens if we get a large number of proposals, say someone tags it as unicorn as a theme. I think at that point, we could then look at that, read the proposal, and see, okay, well, this is actually probably more suited for cybersecurity, put it over there, or this is actually probably more suited for human rights. But then it at least offers some flexibility. So for someone who doesn't want to be bothered thinking of a theme, or just they know it's, you know, they know they're definitely doing privacy, there's guidance there. And also people can see what already exists as well and get a good idea of, okay, well, there's a gap here, so maybe I can propose this theme. I think that's how we could address that problem if we went under a hybrid approach. Thank you.
Thank you, Cheryl. Flavio, you have the floor.
Thank you, Lynn. Just would like to speak again for the hybrid model. I fully agree with Cheryl. We should not fear that people will come up with a unicorn tag or something like that. As Cheryl said, if this is the case, this will be for a very small number of workshops with a very few number of tags that are completely unrelated to internet governance main aspects. Then we can just correct those tags for easing the task of clustering the workshops afterwards. So I think that if we propose a list of 20, clustered or not, this we can decide. If we already prescribe some clustering before, or we just give a list of unclustered 20, how many topics we have there, if we forget the clusters, we have about 25 topics. That's not too much. So we say these are possible tags, but you are free to propose additional tags. So that we give this opportunity to the community to feel that we are following a bottom-up approach and leaving it flexible to people to propose other things. And then for clustering, even if you do not cluster before, it's not so hard. We have these six main clusters already. The tags that will come up will be not too much different from those main aspects there. And there is always, that we have been having this for many years, these emerging issues sub-theme. So things that do not fit well into the five first ones, they will fit into emerging issues. So I don't see too many, too much of a difficulty in clustering before, afterwards, and leave now an unclustered list of 25 topics, and then give a few days for the MAG members to see if they want to add something in the list that will be published in this first call for proposals. So thank you.
Okay, thank you, Flavio. There's another four or five people on the list, but I just want to try and, I think, consolidate where we are to make sure we don't lose these threads. It seems as though there's sort of an emerging consensus that we certainly need to leave flexibility, that working through a notion of, I'm trying to avoid the word tags, tagging or a set of possible issue areas identified either individually in 25 line items or clustered into six. It seems as though that's supported as an approach here in the room. And I would like to know if that's sort of fair or not, because then I think the next question is, does the room feel any burning need to identify specifically one or two sub-themes? I don't want to let that go without specifically addressing it. And I really would like some, you know, some newer voices as well. We do have a queue here, but again, the two things I'm looking for is I saw heads nodding when I said yes. It appears as though we're going to a hybrid, which is going to allow some flexibility. I think we need to figure out how we structure that. So I think there's support in the room for that. And then I think the modalities a little bit, and whether or not we feel there's a burning need to have any specific sub-themes identified. And with that in the queue, I actually have Miguel, Jack, Russia, Zumi, and another five below that. But Miguel, you have the floor.
Well, I'd like to support what Flavio just said. And I think we should have predefined clusters, but not show them in the forms. And then in the form, we could have a field for sub-theme, but we may have predefined sub-themes, but while the proposals are being written, we could suggest them. And only if they don't fit, they will write a new one. That's why, while we are writing different words, we'll maybe be suggesting them for something in order to apply. So that we won't get a long list, we would be shortening the list, and then if there are really new things, we're going to take them into account.
Okay, thank you, Miguel. I'd like to give maximum 10 more minutes to this discussion, given the other ones in front of us, and I think there's fairly high consensus. So if you're in support, then I think we can take that as support. If there's something you want to comment that you think affects the direction overall, then please let some do that. So give everybody a moment to put their flags down if we've made enough progress that we can do that, and if not, we'll continue working through the list. We do have Jack online, though, so we'll take Jack's comment.
Jack, you have the floor now.
Yes. This is Jack. I just wanted to support the bottom-up approach in order to have some themes emerging, and whether this is in entirety or in hybrid. I also wanted to say that since if this is happening, then the main theme would be quite an important part of providing some guidance to the workshop proposers. In which case there should be kind of maybe like a page that articulates all of the different components that we spoke about in the discussion earlier to make sure that this is also part of what we envisage in the inclusive and sustainable growth. For example, linkage to the SDGs, that it should speak directly to the impact on human life, that human rights is a core concept, and so on. And for the clustering, I think that we should distinguish between themes and tags, right? And whilst you may be free to come up with as many tags as possible, which is something that has been done anyway in previous IGS, then the task is then to cluster these facts into thematic areas that it may seem, thematic areas that will emerge. The only worry I have is that we might feel like in our minds a little bit still very bound to the themes that we've had before, and that's actually not allowing ourselves the space to actually see how the themes in fact can produce new areas for the IGF to also look at. So in that sense, I would maybe push more for lesser predetermined sub-themes and to give more space for new themes to emerge, and not to cluster them all as just under emerging issues, but rather to name them as sub-themes in themselves, in their own, in its own right, I guess.
Yeah, thank you, Jack. You made two interesting comments, I think, and I also think at the same time we need to be careful not to mix themes and tags, because your first comment actually said, what I took away from your first set of comments was we can go through this call for workshop proposals, see what comes in, tag them, and then the themes come up from that. That says in mid-July we actually have the sub-themes underneath the themes from which we can really go out and then promote the program itself, because we will have gone through the workshop and the workshop evaluation process. So one option would be to go to, I think, what was Flavio's proposal, which was to get to some list, I think you said 30, which I have to admit I think seems quite long, but some list of sort of 20, I don't know, items or issues or areas or, again, I'm trying not to use the word tags because I think that's confusing to some people, but that we would encourage people to submit to, and then we would pull the sub-themes out of the final submissions that come in that are actually approved by the MAG. So I don't know if that's a way forward. We would obviously need to get some people to go away quite quickly and suggest those 20. I think, Vera, your proposal of doing some of this through a set of clusters is interesting. I think the second point that I thought was interesting in Jack's is that having the clusters might draw people back to a traditional set of topics and things, and to some extent kind of minimize the innovation and flexibility we're trying to give through this process. But let me just finish going around the room to make sure we get some other voices in here as well. And I think we have Rasha in the back.
Thank you. One way to resolve this is to sort of include a statement that says themes include but are not restricted to. And so that gives people the flexibility of proposing something outside of these themes. And I would suggest sticking to the main themes and making these as broad as possible so that people can interpret them in whichever way they want, rather than having like a list of 20 very specific sub-themes. And maybe just have a slot on the application that says, you know, a relevant theme to what your application is. That would help us sort through things. And one of the options on that could be a pull-down menu, and one of the options would be other. So it would already be sorted out for us, but it would also encourage people to sort of stick to the themes, but still give them a way out if they wanted to. My other point very quickly is I would like to see human rights as one of the main themes rather than security, privacy, and openness, because I think human rights may be the broader theme, and I think these other topics would fall under that, underneath it. Thank you.
So what I heard was you basically supporting this cluster approach, and I think your second point...
With giving some flexibility to people going outside of that.
Right, yeah. And I think your second point was also to make human rights its own category. The next in the queue, Shivan, are you still in the queue?
Thank you. In line with the overarching theme that we've chosen, enabling inclusive and sustainable growth, I would suggest that, and also in line with our earlier discussion, which has been repeated every year, to try to get more government representatives to listen to not just come and speak in the beginning, but to somehow participate more substantially. I would suggest that we add a theme called technology and society to nurture discussions of the disruptive sometimes force in certain communities of technology and policies that can alleviate it, or at least comparison of different policies that different countries are using, or at the very least a platform for discussion of how to address those. One that I've mentioned a few times in my interventions is addressing inequalities, and there are rising inequalities in how technology sometimes, and the internet is sometimes introduced in countries. So I think that there is a need for such a platform, for such a discussion, and an ongoing one at that, not just for this year, but for future years as well. So the specific proposal is perhaps instead of Internet Governance for Development, to introduce a theme called Technology and Society, and within it to have a sub-theme of policies to address inequalities.
So, again, I hear you going for a clustered approach as well and simply suggesting
I'm fully okay with a hybrid one, with whatever is flexible, but I think that this issue should float somewhere, but I'm okay with a flexible hybrid approach.
Okay, thank you, Jivan. Hossam, you have the floor.
Thank you, Madam Chair. Well, let me just highlight that from what I understood, those are more tracks than being sub-themes. Those are the tracks that we have seen through the previous IGF happening, which mean many of the workshop goes within those tracks somehow. And I want to make sure that we understand there is still a difference between those tracks and the thematic sessions that would take place, the main session. So those are two different things that might have different titles, etc. The five main tracks are given. I mean, there will be always things under those five main tracks. So having, maybe we can give ourselves a period of time just to suggest one or two more tracks. This is okay. Or taking emerging issues, and then if we find that many workshops will be coming under emerging issue and will have clear tracks, then we again would give a name for those tracks. So it's more of a hybrid model, but this is sort of a mind mapping. It helps us clearly see what are the main tracks that we generally provide work, that we receive workshop within during the previous years. Suggestion is still, I said it before, is if possible, when organizing the workshop and the thematic session, as possible is to have the workshop leading to thematic session. It will be, it will need some heavy work from the secretariat, but it's really very important so that we can come within the thematic session with some conclusion out of the whole work. Thank you very much.
Thank you, Hassam. And yes, I think this is different from the thematic sessions, the main blocks, which we will come to very shortly. I had Cisse. You have the floor? No? Omar, you have the floor?
Thank you, Chair. There are a few keywords, and sometimes they're confusing. And these are themes, sub-themes, tracks, tags, topics, and subjects. These are the words we often confuse. We have discussed the main theme, and then there are the sub-themes, which Hossam called as tracks. And there are the sub-themes, right? There could be, I mean, if we clearly define these for the MAC members and the people who are proposing workshops, it's going to be easier to understand and select from amongst them. And also, I'm suggesting the hybrid model, as well as I spoke about it yesterday. There could be a topic, for example, cloud. Somebody is proposing something on cloud, but it's also relevant to the, that's an emerging issue, but it's also relevant to the access and diversity, the proposal. So that means it's access and diversity, but at the same time, it's cloud. But my proposal would be there is one main theme selected and then sub-themes also selected, because that will, for example, the main theme could be under the access and diversity, but it's also relevant to cloud, so that could become the sub-theme under that. And then we could give an option to the proposers to make a selection from the drop-down list we are providing, or add their own themes in there, or suggest or propose their own themes, so that we can collect the proposed themes and make a final list of that. And tags are really, the attacks could be many, because you know they're basically the different keywords used in a topic. So if there is the proposal on a website, we could tag a lot of different keywords, which will make it easier for the participants to find their desired workshops. And also, as a last point, there is a proposal on including digital equality as a sub-theme, and that's digital equality in terms of internet dynamics and core values in the Asia-Pacific region. That was a proposal which came from there. Thank you.
Thank you, Omar. We have Wisdom in the queue.
Thank you, Madam Chair. I was just thinking through open government initiatives are gaining grounds globally. And then within the African region, African countries are adopting to these open government initiatives. And then in my country, for instance, are tagging internet governance to it, so that they are driving both internet governance and then open data initiatives. So I will propose that we include internet governance within the sub-teams, And then with the internet governance, you have camps and the following. You could have open data within the open government. You could also have transparency, accountability, as well as technology and then innovation. So we should also try and consider this.
Thank you, Wisdom. I think we have another three or four people in the queue. We need to close this and figure out how we're going to move forward on the work. We still have a couple of items in front of us. Virat, you're next in the queue.
Thank you, Madam Chair. Just wanted to say that I didn't present this as a point of view. I just presented this to show that if you had to go for a cluster approach, you can use it. But I actually have a question for the Secretariat, whose work I'm deeply concerned with. If they get a set of 150 odd sub-themes, let us say we completely remove this, remove the hybrid approach, go to the excellent suggestions made first by Liesl, supported by Jack, several people, innovation. Will you be in a position as a Secretariat in the 7-day period to cluster these in 5 or 6 themes and present them as a part of the program that has been done for the at least last 2 or 3 years to help people guide which sessions they want to go to without having to read all the details of every session? That's a operational challenge that falls upon you in the 7 days if we go to the innovative approach. That's one question. Second, if I'm submitting something under human rights and you tag it under cybersecurity, then who's willing to deal with the complaint that will follow at the venue where the organizers will say we're in the wrong color or section? I'm just on the practical issues which you will have to face if you have an open bottom-up approach. If we can deal with that, we should really go with that.
I think we're going to have complaints or issues both ways, whichever way we do it. Even now, in previous ways, when we have this self-tagging or self-classification, there's some workshops that are clearly not in that category, but they put it in that category for maybe because there are less workshops in that category or for some other reason. So, I mean, either way, I think we can try and work with it. But another point is that we are going to try and do it as they come in. If you submit and then it's published, then we'll try and do it instead of waiting until they all come in. And so it will take we will have more time than those 7 days per se.
Madam Chairperson, can I just, in that case, if this question is on, and unless there is any reason to for us to cluster or give guidance, then we should just leave it open, let people come up. If the Secretariat feels confident about it, then let's just give the choice. Well, I think you should really, if you can do this in a bottom-up approach, I think it's perfect. We should innovate. We don't need to give people prescriptions.
Do you need a moment?
They have to do it.
They want the hybrid.
You want the hybrid? You prefer the hybrid approach?
So
we should actually, because it's an operational issue. It's not just us telling.
So with some trepidation, I'm going to leave you. The operational issue, I think, would be, can you get the online submission to enable self-identification of tags? Because I think we should allow people mm-hmm. to do that first. Maybe some point down the stream in a review, we decide that the workshop proposal really is better in some other area. But I think that's a decision the MAG should take when they review the proposals. So I think the work for the Secretariat at an operational level is ensuring that the online form will allow identification and selection against some number of tags.
Well, then we are back to identifying 25 tags.
No, I don't think there's 125. I think
25 tags, 25 tags.
Or 20 or 25 yeah. tags yeah. is the number that everybody keeps shaking their head, except for...
get what you get and you don't get what you get.
So 20 tags and then saying others.
Yeah, that's what I was thinking.
If they come, we should
how
go
many
with
tags per workshop.
per, so 20, I think we're saying 20 tags in total is a choice plus an other, and that each workshop would be allowed 3 tags. Is that what everybody has been? I see Flavio nodding his head, and Mike shaking his hand, and Juan looking for the floor. So let me see if Juan can help clarify
this. 3 tags?
Yes, Chair. As I said before, I think that I understand the problem that we are. But what I recommend is what we need now. I think that what we need, the sub-themes now, or the themes, or whatever, it's very important what my colleague from the Netherlands said, that I think there's a lot of confusion here. What are tags? What are topics? What are that? I think really what we need is 2 things. The first thing that we need, not now, as Virat said, not now, is that eventually all the 100 workshops should be classified. Classified, that's my thing. If you, maybe you can call it tags or whatever, but it's to classify. As he said very clearly, in order that somebody who goes there that can see, oh, I'm interested in this and that, and that, so that's classification. But we will never know that classification until we receive the workshops. I think that's the beauty of the proposal of Yaxi and Avri that I subscribe. But why do we need then sub-themes? Because we have to make a call for workshops. I have worked in many scientific events. We always have, as you know, what is called the call for papers, in which in the call for papers, you put the topics, because we're doing an event in ICT, maybe not an event in cuisine or in agriculture. It's very interesting, but maybe this is not the place. So we put that in that. So I think that if we go the way of putting 20 topics, we feel the risk of what do we leave out? Did they leave out? It's included or not? So I think that we should do, and what I propose to do it here now, is to draft the letter calling for the submissions, in which we already agreed in the main theme. Of course, that will be the main theme. Then we have this paragraph put in the context that this year happened this and that. And so after that, we call on workshops. And by the way, we need to work in the 7 proposals of structure of the workshops. I think in the list there was a discussion, very interesting, that Amelia and Marilyn Kate mentioned that this the description is not very clear, and we had round tables, there were panels and not round tables. I think that document, that by the way is not online, it had to go back online for the proposers to really guide themselves, needs to be worked out also. But well, that's a parenthesis. We need to make this letter. If we can do it now, at least the content of this letter, I repeat that I think we don't need a 20 list. I think that we should put something as a guidance, something such as topics, and leave it open. And then when we get, as you clear, the task is not of the secretariat, it's to the evaluators. One of the tasks of the evaluator, we in the MAG, when we receive a workshop, is to put into what category you think this workshop. Again, maybe I put one category and Flavio puts other, but in the end, in the meeting or in the list, we agree to which category to put. But please, let's make this letter.
So we have 1 hour left here today. I want to see if within the next very few minutes, something less than 5, we can figure out how to move forward on this enough so we can take the next step. I think there's broad agreement on the idea of flexibility and innovation. We have agreement on a call which provides some context and some kind of directional guidance. We were on a track to do that through a list of 25 possible items. No, I'm just for a moment, just stay with me for a minute, please. To have a list of sort of 25 items. If we were to look at the 25, they're probably mostly already captured right there in those themes, you know, plus or minus. I think we're okay on the operational issues with respect to allowing, being able to make the changes which would allow the workshops proposals when they come in to identify three areas, whether it's against a list of 25 or three that they choose freely, but that would actually allow some consolidation was I think the word you used, Juan, to help us process through. I mean, I think that's where we are on the discussion now. I think there's only two ways to close that, and that's you let the secretariat, I'm spending the day with the secretariat tomorrow, the secretariat and I go away and try and pull all this together and get a more precise proposal out to the MAG. We would need a very fast turnaround from the MAG, though, because our timeline that we adopted yesterday has a call going out the end of next week. And we really don't have any, you know, room for slippage in that call. The other alternative, of course, we could try and get, a small, which I'm perfectly willing to do. I can't speak and wouldn't dare to speak for the secretariat after, how long these days have already been. I'm willing to stay after tonight for a period of time with a small working group and see if we can progress that. And again, we would still get a proposal out to the full MAG. At this point in time, I don't see a way to close it concretely where I think people would be happy and I would feel comfortable that we were all on the same page. And I also don't want to take the rest of the hour on that without having some time on main sessions, location of the second MAG meeting, and the workshop proposals. I think we need to keep some forward momentum on those items as well. So with that, 60 minutes, actually right now, 56 minutes. Please, you have the floor, Juan.
Maybe a solution is to do that call paper, small, and to put as an annex, say, to annex this one with another one that says other topics of your consideration or something like that. And that's it. This serves as a guidance. Maybe you can put in the letter, as a guidance, we are annexing the topics of previous events. Of previous events, just as a guidance, and it's an annex to the call letter,
people
can guide themselves. But please include others, so people are not felt they have an idea that is not there that they cannot present it.
There will definitely be another, and I do think it's important to split out along some of the lines we had, security, openness, and privacy. You're right. So, I mean, I think that's a reasonable way forward. I like the putting an annex and putting some more behind. I would think that we could, I hope, with the secretariat and myself tomorrow, get a call out that shapes all of this a little bit more and what the call might look like. Might need to move to, Friday morning, giving us Thursday night as well, but and ask that to be turned around by Monday. Is that a reasonable approach? There's still some flags up, so I honestly, I'd rather not take any more questions on this until we try and consolidate the discussions we've had historically, but if somebody feels that it's a critical question or a critical comment, then we should do that. I would just ask everybody to keep in mind that it will take from main sessions and location of second MAG meetings and workshop proposal. So with that, I will do one more look around the room for quick. I saw Laura Liesel, and I'm sorry, I don't think you're a MAG member, but Laura, if you can go first, you have the floor.
Thank you. I will be really quick. It just seems to me if we're taking away, we're kind of letting go slightly by not being too restrictive with the sub-themes and letting people self-select, or we're happy for the secretariat to then put into sub-themes. We're then imposing control in a different way by giving people a list of tags or however we want to classify it to then pick from. I just wonder whether we could just let go a little bit and let people put their own tags or whatever we call them in terms of how they would like to classify and what they feel their kind of headlines and key points are. We could provide an annex, as been suggested, in terms of things they might like to consider just to help them, but I would kind of suggest letting go slightly.
Yeah, and I think we're all on with the letting go, but I think on the other, we need to make sure we can process in a timely manner on the back end. And I think that's just where some level which says, help us sort this out so we're not trying to look across similar, you know, terms defining a tag. And but I think we can go away and think about that in a little bit more relaxed manner. Liesl?
Thank you, Chair, for indulging me. 2 seconds. I just wanted to reiterate a comment I put in the responses for the meeting this morning to discuss this, saying that we do need to, and I'm sorry if you said this while I had stepped out, but we do need to explain why we're leaving those, why we want the hashtags. Previously, we had the hashtags, but no explanation as to how they were to be used. If we're going to say they'll be used for developing sub-themes as based on the word, I think you'll have a better response anyway. Thank you.
Thank you, Liesl. Okay, we still have quite a few, if it can make your comments brief. Marilyn, you've been in for a while, and then McCann and
I'm
Omar.
Marilyn Kate. I'm going to make a very brief comment, and then I'm going to ask Andrea just to make a quick comment about accessibility. I, last year, experienced the problem of trying to coach some new workshop proposers who really felt that they should add absolutely every hashtag they possibly could and every label they possibly could so that they would get attention. And they became confused, and so did the people trying to find them. So even though I don't consider it, you know, I'm happy to have some flexibility. I think there's got to be a little bit of quality control and standardization so that, because it isn't just the workshop proposer we're trying to satisfy, it is the participants who need to be able to use this information to find their way around. So there's got to be a little bit of a standard.
Thank you, Marilyn.
And I'll be fast. Accessibility for persons with disability usually is nameless and under access and diversity. I would like to raise its identity so the words are actually there, and perhaps in compliance with the UNCRPD. And I think it would be good to actually have it visible. And that's my only comment, and thank you.
Could you get a note to the Secretariat to make sure we captured it correctly? Thank you.
Yes.
Omar?
Thank you. I support Marilyn on her point. A topic, Madam Chair, it says is a specific subject throughout a piece of writing, and theme is the main idea, central idea of the author's message. A tag is a non-hierarchical keyword or term assigned to a piece of information. When you're working with the Secretariat on the deciding about this, I'd suggest if the Secretariat can also work on defining themes, sub-themes, categories, for example, tracks, tags, topics, and subjects. So there is a clarification on in for the future, and no confusion. My proposal would be including one theme, three sub-themes, like theme number one, theme number two, sub-theme one, sub-theme two, and sub-theme three, and there could be about 25 tags, as you suggested.
Thank you.
But also, sorry
briefly,
about that.
Please.
The tax should not be very generic, like internet, cyberspace, for example, governance.
I think that's good advice. Yeah. Thank you. McCann, you have the floor.
Thank you, Madam Chair. As the main theme is enabling inclusive and sustainable growth, and I don't think that we can have inclusive of anything if woman is not part of the process. And as you know, most of developing country women are left out from the from the knowledge economy. So I suggest that we can have a sub-team called Women Empowerment and Gender Equality. Thank you.
Thank you, McCann. Okay, so I think we have agreement on that, probably as much as we're going to get at this point in time, and we'll work with the Secretariat tomorrow and get the next phase out. We may reach out to some of you specifically to help with some of the kind of finer points here. Main sessions or thematic sessions is one of the two remaining. We have three items left on our, it's kind of understand a little bit about main sessions, thematic sessions, where we're going. I think I'd like to get a good start on that today. We can probably take the rest of it to a virtual call. We do still have the workshop proposals and guidelines in front of us, and given a lot of people stayed up late and got up early this morning for a meeting of the working group, I'd like to see if we can close that today. If you think we should take it to the mailing list and give people till Monday, I think that's an option as well. So I'll leave it there. And then we need a item on the location of the second MAG meeting. Again, those dates were July 13, 14, and 15. But to the extent we get some sense of MAG preference, and we can go away and see what the options are. Main sessions, just quickly, we have 8 3-hour slots. Two of those are reserved today for opening ceremony and closing ceremony. There is a slide, but I think we have to let Lewis take a break for a moment. I think it's a relatively easy concept. Primarily, we have 2 3-hour slots. Here comes Lewis. And typically what we've done is tried to, and they really are thematic sessions. There are other workshop proposals running in parallel to that, so it's not...
the main sessions.
The opening ceremony and the closing ceremony do not have competing workshop panels, or is that a correct statement? They're plenaries and... Right. So we have 6 3-hour slots. Flavio's correcting me.
We had the experience in 2015 of extending the duration of each day's schedule, and we had 2 3-hour, we had 1 4-hour slot and 1 3-hour slot per day, so that we had some main sessions which were 2 plus 2 hours. We just extended the duration of the work of the interpreters. You remember that? So we have a little bit more flexibility if we do the same in Mexico. So we may have 3 and 4 hour slots, not only 3 hour slots.
Okay, well, that's actually a very good point, because even with a 4-hour slot, theoretically, you could still have 2 2-hour slots and have a fairly substantive discussion, and maybe that's a way to square some of the comments we had this morning. We were trying to put two like things into the same slot. But rather than work, because I think you're right, Flavio, there probably is some flexibility, and certainly Victor and Ileana were clear that there's flexibility there on site. Should we just try and get a quick sense of proposals for main sessions or thematic sessions? We'll capture those, and then maybe we can see how far we can process them here in this meeting, but then take them to a virtual meeting. But at least we'll get the kind of the universe of possible thematic sessions out. So the floor is open. We don't need a lot of description on what would happen in those slots. I mean, primarily kind of a title and a very brief indication of what would be captured. So where's the list start right here? So Rasha? Did you have your flag up for this particular?
No.
Cheryl, then I guess you were first, and then Farah McCann, Marilyn.
Thank you, Madam Chair. I think that it would be important to have a main session on the intersessional work, and I'd like to volunteer to help with that, and would love someone else to volunteer as well to work with me. Thank you.
So that would be the connecting the next billion, whatever its final name is. I think there was high support for that earlier, too, so you could probably treat that as a given. Just in order, it was Virat, Marilyn, Juan.
So after my first request is to try and make it more orderly than we were. We had 9 sessions at Brazil, and that is the reason why they were ending at different times and stuff. We have to remember one thing. Delegates must know that main sessions begin at, actually it says 9 a.m., it should be 10 a.m. They begin at 10, they finish at 1. Lunch has to be between 2, 1, and 3. And we should preferably close at 6, though we made that exception in Brazil. By and large, in all other IGFs, we've closed at 6 o'clock. Going for 2-hour slots and 90-minute slots for the main session disrupts the grid and requires a lot of background work to try and fit these things in. It's not that it can't be done, but I just want to caution against the work that it takes at the end. If we go with the discussion that have happened so far, best practice and dynamic coalitions will probably take away 3 hours, at least.
Times two or one?
One. So best practice is about six best practice sessions and about 13 dynamic coalitions, of which about 10 or 11 present. So you get about 15 to 16 presenters for about 5 minutes each. That's how it works out.
So I think one of the things we could do is take back to the individuals from the MAG that help coordinate the dynamic coalitions and the best practice forums and see what works for them.
That's one option, to sort of see if we can bring these two together, because bringing them together will really help.
Honestly, I'm a little less concerned about helping the schedule and more ensuring that the efforts are actually getting the time and attention they need. So let's just ask them if they could cohabit in the same three-hour slot, I guess, is what we're
intersessional
proposing.
Work will require one. I think it usually requires one. So that now leaves us with four slots.
Do you have a proposal for another one? I'm going to go to someone
I
know
does. I have a proposal for, either sustainable development or sustainable development goals. I'm happy to volunteer to work on that and see if we can try and get that. That's a broad topic, but we can try and bring it down to something more specific. And if that's possible, then that can be one session.
Okay, thank you,
Virat. I'm happy to support Marilyn.
I suspect that's what Marilyn was going to come in on. Marilyn, you have the floor.
Thank you. Marilyn Cade, let me support Virat's proposal. I think a main session, leaving aside whatever happens in the high-level meeting, a main session on the SDGs, and again, I propose that we follow and agree to and endorse the approach of that we used on the WSIS Plus 10, and that we are then able to invite the national and regional IGFs to contribute to that, but also really be very participatory. And I wanted to volunteer to work on that. I also wanted to propose, since he's not here, Ambassador Fonseca, who might be able to work with Virat and I. And then secondly, I just want to remind everyone that the national and regional IGFs would like to have their substantive session in the main room.
Thank you, Marilyn. Juan, you have the floor.
Thank you, Chair. I was going to propose the same session in the Sustainable Development Goals, but as a continuation of the session last in João Pessoa that was in Sustainable Development that was organized by Hosan and some other partners. I also collaborate with him. So we have to be very careful not to repeat that one, but to be more with the actual linkage of internet to this. This was outside, have you seen another linkage between the WSIS actions lines and the sustainable development goal? Maybe we should do something similar with internet and best practice and give a special call in that, trying to be sort of a guideline, more practical oriented, you know. This is thing, if somebody has a practice that can help for this, presented there, and it could help some other one. That's one session, and of course, I'm happy to collaborate as always. And another session that it was mentioned, and I think is unavoidable that we have to do it, something is cybersecurity. As you know, cybersecurity is going on, and for December, I think that the GGE already have been summoned. One of the reports will be out. So I think there's a lot of things going on in cybersecurity, and I think that that's a topic that we should we have no choice but to address there. And also I'm happy if I can collaborate. I'm on your hands, Chair.
Thank you, Juan. Hossam, you have the floor, and then Elizabeth. Oh, sorry.
So, okay. Thank you, Chair. This is something that we are discussing, so maybe Elizabeth start and I'll support her for this. Thank you.
Excellent. Thank you, Hassan.
So, I've mentioned a couple of times already that there was this internet and sustainable development session, internet economy and digital, was it internet economy or digital economy? Anyway, internet economy and sustainable development session that happened last year that had all this substance to it that went very well and had a lot of, in particular, some of the developing country government folks afterwards encouraging us to continue working on that. Hossam and I were just sort of pinging back the idea of the 2016 version, what that might be, and we thought that given the broader theme of inclusive growth, we could look at something like internet and inclusive economy and have a session. We'd rethink how it would work with the sustainable development goals to fit into that broader main session theme. And we'd be happy to work with Juan as well to get his ideas again.
Okay. Thank you, Elizabeth and Hossam. Women first, Aida and then Michael.
Thank you. So I would just like us not to forget to leave the slot since we are all about growth here. And it seems we didn't manage to put human rights in the overarching team just to make sure that human rights find a place here. And if we are a bit more braver, I would say, then I would suggest gender as a main session. Thank you.
Thank you, Aida. Michael?
Just to build on what some people have said about the need for a main session on cybersecurity, but I would urge us not to do something similar to what we've done in the past where the focus is on malicious hacking and confidentiality, and instead focus a bit more on reliability and integrity of data. I think we have a great team of people who can put this together, but we tend to focus on data being stolen. We don't focus enough on what happens when your website is down or when you can't control the nuclear power plant because the network has been hacked, the network itself, rather than the data.
Okay, thank you. That actually empties the queue at the moment, so let me try and summarize where I think we are.
I'm sorry, I had my hand up in the beginning as well, perhaps.
Oh,
sorry about that.
No, Jivan, you're absolutely right. Sorry, it's on the list way over here on the side. Apologies. Please, you have the floor.
So I propose the title would be The Internet of Things, IPv6, and Our Future Human Society.
Thank you. At this point, I'm collecting these newer ideas for workshops, and I have a proposal for a moment in terms of how we might advance them. So we're just noting them down. And now there's an online participant.
Jack, you have the floor.
Sorry, this is Jack. Just wanted to note that last year the BPF was in different session from the Dynamic Coalition, so the Dynamic Coalition really needed the time that it needed. And in fact, I think there were some issues around it being split into 2 days. And the BPF instead was linked to the Connecting the Next Billion session. It was fine when the linkages were made to the theme of Connecting the Next Billion, but it wasn't always possible. So I think maybe we should discuss about whether that can be put together or whether the BPF need a session on its own or whether it's enough for the BPF to kind of just put in some main interventions for the Connecting the Next Billion, that it was split into two sections. No one was really looking at the content of the Connecting the Next Billion policy mining paper, and then the other was sort of looking at what came out from the BPF discussions and recommendations. And I also would like to support Marilyn's proposal on IG linked with this SDGs as the main session. And while inclusive economy is a great way to kind of look at this, I would also like to bring back Juan's earlier comments as well, in that growth should not also be sort of limited to economy, but I think sustainable development goals to give it a broader kind of allows it to look at sort of various dimensions of this topic, which might be a little bit more useful. And of course, to support Ginger and Aida's proposal on a main session on human rights, but to build from last year's main session to also bring in economic, social, and political rights. So to kind of look at this in this broader framing as well. Thank you.
Thank you, Jack. Wanawit, you have the floor. This will be the last contribution. Then I think I have a proposal for how we take this forward and next steps. So you have the floor, Wanawit.
Okay. Thank you, Chair. I think from the last CHOPESO meeting, I also participate in one of the topics that relate to trade. They discuss about how TPP or the other trade negotiation is affecting the internet in general. I think the room is full with people sitting on the floor. And I think this year the TPP is concluded, ASEP is on the way. The WTO Trade Facilitation Agreement, Marrakesh 133 article was finalized. There are 85 country provisions on that. And the first chapters even mentioned about the internet, the important roles of internet in giving out the information. So I do believe if the main session will have some of these issues that are cross-cutting that the trade or the things that binding the country in participate in this e-commerce or internet, it's something new for the community. I think if that would be possible to arrange that kind of session. Thank you, Chair.
Thank you, Wanawit. This particular topic is one where we had a mixture of some sort of short-term requirements and more time for some of the others. The shorter-term requirements, I put down things like the NRIs. I can never say that now. the NRIs, the Connecting the Expillion Intercessional Work, the Best Practices DCs, and I think there's been great support for the SDGs as well. But those first three that I spoke about actually are important that we make a decision here that we're going to give them a substantive piece of time because we're counting on their efforts to actually feed and support those. I think there's agreement I saw from the room to allow time for a connecting the next billion set of work. Obviously, if this is a significant piece of intercessional work, it's probably worthy of a full slot. I think sustainable development goals and internet governance is just such a huge and so important that I think there was great support across the room for that taking one of the slots. And then we have the RNIs and the best practice forums and DCs that we were going to go back and work with those coordinators to tell them we're interested in meeting their needs, giving them a substantive period of time, and we need to identify in particular for the BPs and DCs whether they can share a slot, and this might be one of the times where maybe we look to have two-hour slots or something if they can't. So I think that's good in that we've got enough time now to go and give them some direction so they can organize their own efforts, because every week that goes by, there's another internet governance forum somewhere in the world through our activities, and I think it's important that they know that this is working towards something at the IGF. And then there were another, I took five, I'm not sure if the trade point is linked to the internet economy or not. I took five additional topics down, and I'll note that youth was not one of them, although it featured very big in the stock taking from last year and very big in our earlier conversations here the last few days. What I'd like to do with those is to work with the Secretariat to get a list together. Some of the topics actually came with folks who had said they were willing to work on them and to lead them. And I think we just need to process those through the MAG on some of our virtual calls, which will give the folks who are proposing them some time to write up in a little bit more detail what they're actually thinking, what they'd hope to accomplish. And I think we can progress those probably over the next few months, in fact. But I think that's good. We've got sort of the overall shape. And at the same time, I think responding to some sort of short-term requests from some of our, you know, really important intersessional work. So we have the transcript, but we also took some notes in terms of what the proposed were, topics were, and who was willing to lead a discussion with the MAG to see if that makes the thematic session cut off or not when we get there. Are we okay leaving that discussion at that level? Hossam, no?
I just had one comment related to the session that you are talking about, internet and inclusive economy. It just is, we felt it's a must because it is building on the main session that took place in Brazil, and we had a lot of feedback asking to build on that. This is just the point. Okay.
So I think that's a good point. I think we're aware of it. I think that's probably fairly similar for a lot of the other subjects as well. So I think it's just worthy of a little more thought, some concrete proposals, and we'll revisit them in some of our virtual meetings.
In reality, the main session required about 5 months of work. So even if we can get everything done and ready by our July meeting, we will have 5 months to then execute it. So lots of time.
Right.
And usually, the one principle that we followed since last year is no repeating speakers, and making sure that, you know, anything that is not 3 hours should preferably be in the second half, because you can go over the first half, the lunch has to happen at once. So that's how the scheduling has to occur. And we can go to more than that if we go with like the 90-minute sessions, or 1 hour, 1 2-hour session and a 90-minute session, let's say BPF. Right. One. So all that is available. We can do it later. We have lots of time.
And we do have lots of time, and compared to some of the other things we've had to do here the last few days. But I will work with the secretary to get the request out formally to everybody, because if we can advance those topics over the next month or two, we'll be prepared to have some substantive discussions at the July meeting without having it impinged on everybody's workshop evaluation rating time. So we'll move it forward.
Yeah, hopefully close it
by July. No, exactly. So we'll work to move that forward. Two items left. One is a discussion on the location of our second MAG meeting, and then the other one is I haven't had time to see how the reaction is to the workshop proposal guideline work that has come out. Are we prepared to take that decision here on the basis of the working group this morning, or do people need time to go away and look at the work that was done and come back with no later than Monday? And I guess not hearing, we'd assume a presumptive support. So again, if some of you have had a chance to look at it, I'd appreciate some indication as to whether we're close enough or we need to allow a bit more time to close on that. So Marilyn, you have the floor, and then Virhat.
Thank you, Chair. Marilyn Cade speaking. I want to speak about a brief comparison that I did, and it is truly not a statistical analysis. I took a look, and I posted to the MAG list. I took a look last night at the implications of holding a working MAG session outside of Geneva and potentially trying to hold it in Mexico. I didn't distinguish between either Mexico City or Guadalajara. I started out trying to compare the cost difference, and I found it very difficult because I couldn't predict whether a traveler would choose economy or economy plus or business. But what I could do was to compare the time of travel. And so I did that, and I posted a few of those facts to all of you. And let me just say that we have to give a medal to Fiji and Japan, New Zealand, and Australia for always having to spend over 30 to 35 hours in order to meet with us wherever we are. But let me go on to the more detailed analysis. You can look at it yourself, but I'll just cover a few of them. To fly from Addis to Geneva is somewhere around 10 to 12 hours. It depends on if it's a direct flight or not. And Nairobi would be somewhat similar in that time. To fly from Addis or Nairobi to Mexico, it is 29 hours or 32 hours or 39 hours with multiple stops. To fly from Geneva to Mexico, it is 21 or 22 or 18 hours. To fly from Egypt to, and these are just examples of Expedia-driven examples that I took. To fly from Cairo to Geneva, it's 9 to 13 hours, or 13 hours. From Egypt to Mexico, it's 24 to 27 hours. From Paris to Mexico, it's 20 to 21 to 22 hours. To Geneva, it's 2 to 3 hours. From Fiji, to Mexico, it's 33.5 hours, and it's about that time, the amount of time to come to Geneva as well. From Afghanistan to Geneva, it's 11 hours, more or less, and from Afghanistan to Mexico, it's 22 hours. Now, when you do an analysis of flying from Argentina to Mexico, the time is much less. Or if you fly from Colombia to Mexico, the time is much less. To fly from the U.S. to Geneva, if it's direct, it's about 7 hours from Washington or New York. If it, you have a stop, it's about 10 or 11 hours. It's only about 3 or 4 hours to fly to Mexico. But I was trying to look at this in terms of the time commitment, because if a large number of our MAG members are traveling over 20 hours to get to a meeting, we have to consider that a three-day meeting may only be 3 working days, but we have got to take into account the wear and tear on our participants. We would also have to pay the fly for the IGF secretariat, and for a working MAG member meeting, frankly, I think we need the entirety of the secretariat present with us. So as I said, I didn't go into cost, but I propose that it's not really simple to confirm taking a working MAG meeting out of Geneva for July. I'd like to postpone any decision about a working MAG meeting that in September that might be held in Mexico to a later date, make a decision that we are going to work in Geneva. I'll say one other thing. It is not practical to go to New York for the meeting in July due to the ECOSOC competing meetings and availability of rooms, et cetera. And I think also we have visa issues to always consider if we're going to a new location, on whether MAG members can easily, particularly MAG members who don't have reciprocal agreements for their countries, the time it takes for them to get visas.
Thank you, Marilyn. I was just trying to talk to Yolanda here because I was trying to assert that we were actually invited to Mexico before we started debating whether or not the timeline was. And Yolanda said, in fact, you know, they were happy to host any MAG meeting. Chengatai says there are facilities here available in Geneva for our date as well, the CICG near the ITU building in that area over there.
New York.
And is there a position on New York?
In New York, it's possible, although it's in July during HLPF. But I've made a quick check. It's possible their conference, but we do need to confirm early, and that means sometime in the next 2 weeks in order to get a location in New York.
It's Marilyn. I'm sorry to take the floor, but I must ask a clarifying question of why I'm in. As a business representative, I attended every one of the preparatory meetings in New York at the United Nations. And I must say that I really question, given what else is going on there, I really question the practicality of trying to have the working sessions where we may have to decide on the fly that we are going to stay very late or we're going to change the needs that we have to the IT group. And I also am very familiar with the challenges of badging in a large number of non-accredited parties. And I'm looking at some of my colleagues from business because we encountered significant challenges where we couldn't get last minute badges easily. And I'm just really, you know, when we say it's possible, I frankly look at that meeting and think that we're going to be working from 8:30 in the morning until potentially 9 or 10 o'clock at night.
So I'm not quite sure how the MAG has come to its decisions in the past. Maybe we weren't quite so invited.
We've never had a choice.
It was your choice is Geneva or Geneva. Or forget Geneve. So I'm not quite sure how we close this quite quickly. We could either do a quick show of hands if there's a strong preference one way or the other. It doesn't appear to me that there are criteria that the MAG has ever used before to enable these sorts of decisions. And, you know, I think information on visas and information on flight times and things is interesting, but that's hard to get to something, particularly the flight times, because, you know, wherever you are, it will, particularly if you're spread about across the world, you're going to be, you know, have a shorter flight time or a longer flight time. So I'm not going to square that circle just now. We have a request for the floor from George from Switzerland. So George, you have the floor.
Okay, thank you very much. And just to take the floor very quickly, I guess that with so many invitations, just to remind ourselves that we are always invited to be here in Geneva, and that we are happy to host the IGF in this city. I think that more on a general point of view, we should take into account, and this was in part said by Marilyn, on the one side that we maximize participation and inclusiveness in any meeting, especially if it's, as we are used to do it, open MAG meetings, also especially if there is a link with an open consultation in that meeting. So maximizing participation and inclusiveness is one factor, and also on the other side, of course, minimizing costs, because as we know, this is a very lightweight endeavor, so if we can minimize costs, it's always a criterion which we should take into account. And with that, you all know that the synergies with the representations, both from the private sector, the civil society, academia, governments in Geneva, are well placed. But I'll leave it at that, and I'll leave it at your discretion, of course. Thank you.
Thank you, George. And I certainly know we've always appreciated the support from Switzerland. I think at this point, since I think it's going to be quite a personal decision, depending on what meetings we have before and afterwards and where we come from, that we should take it to a doodle poll. In the meantime, we can clarify what the offers are and room availabilities are. I can see pros and cons of things such as easy access to facilities, and I think determining where it might be in Mexico as well is certainly another criteria, I think, for flights in. So we don't have a lot of time. As Waymin said, we need to make the decision quite soon, but maybe we could, early part of next week, get a doodle poll out to everybody. I hope that that's not just kicking the fun down the road in terms of decision, but I don't think making one here quite on the fly without knowing where we're going to Mexico, and a number of people have left already, and I'm not sure who's online, is really the most thoughtful way to do that just now. So that's my proposal, that we move to a doodle poll next week. Is that supported? Vera, do you have a comment?
Yeah, I think we should move to a doodle poll. I just want to make two quick points. One is the fact that in terms of costs, roughly based on the membership of the MAG, the costs and the time of travel will go down for approximately 37% to 40% of the members, and the cost and travel time will go up for approximately 60% to 63% of the members. This is based on if we go to Mexico. So this is based on the division of the MAG between people, members who are from Latin America and North America, and members who are from Europe, Asia, and Africa, where the price and cost sort of goes up. So just keep in mind that number. I just want to clarify one thing. The distinguished delegate from Switzerland said, happy to host a MAG meeting or IGF. I heard IGF, so is that like a proposal for the next IGF? I wanted to check. I will be happy.
In fact, 2017, 18, 19,
is open, 20, yeah.
21,
that's,
yeah. You know, are all open. Herman, you have the floor.
Thank you, Madam Chair. Herman Valdez. I think if we have, we are in the scenario that the Mexican government can provide the support to the MAC Secretariat and we can review those costs and we can move forward on that proposal. I don't see the reason why reject the kind invitation of the Mexican government to attend in a July meeting in Mexico. The truth is there is no fair for everybody in a particular place. I mean, it's always someone needs to pay the price for a particular place. More time, more hours. The same with a time for a teleconference. Someone needs to pay the early mornings, 3, 4 a.m. And if we are looking for innovation, I think it will be very interesting to experience a MAC meeting in the host country for the first time. It could be also an opportunity to those MAC members who needs to visas to get to Mexico. Could be this opportunity to resolve that issue if they are going to attend later in the year in December to IGF in Mexico. This could be the opportunity to have those visas arranged in this for this meeting in July. So I welcome the proposal to have these discussions. I propose that we keep this option open. Thank you.
I think I appreciate the comments, and I think all three options are open. I don't think we have the ability here to just close the options down out of hand. I don't feel that that's actually respectful or thoughtful enough. We're breaking new ground with respect to these multiple offers, and I think we should go away and we can all do some due diligence. We can ask the Secretariat to work with the both Wai Min and Victor and Yolanda to understand what the specifics are of those offers and take it to the list. I really think that's the only thing that's fair. Cheryl, I'll give you the floor and then we should move to the final item then.
Thank you, Madam Chair. On the doodle poll, I would also add Paris just to see. I mean, that's another option if we're comparing costs, et cetera. And I would mention as well, we're gonna have a third meeting. So even if we can't decide, you know, here, there, Mexico, this meeting, I mean, maybe we'll have more time to discuss it and do the third meeting in Mexico. Thank you.
No, that's an option. And actually, Changitai just said we had an offer from Brussels as well, from the European Commission. So I think we need to put our heads together a little bit. As I said, we've never had this situation before. And we all know that the hardest thing in the world to get agreement on across anything more than two people is the location of a meeting. We did well yesterday on the dates, and we'll work towards the location here over the next few days. I need somebody to help me understand where we might be with respect to the workshop proposals and guideline, the work that came out of the working group this morning. Have enough people in the room looked at it? Are we ready to close, or do we think we need more time? And I think, Susan, you're looking for the floor, hopefully.
Thank you, Chair. The track changes have been circulated, so I guess it's up to you or the MAG members to decide when or for how long you'd like to solicit any further changes, and I remain available to assist with that.
For the floor, we have Slobodan, Michael, go to you last, Vera, and Herman, are you still in the queue? Slobodan, you have the floor.
Thank you, Madam Chair. I took a look at the latest versions of the guidelines posted to the mailing list, and I have only one short but important note. Because as far as I understand, these are going to be the documents that we are going to put together with the call, right? So I would like to ask Susan, basically, just to reconsider the wording that I originally proposed regarding the online participation, because the way the text is now structured implies that using WebEx and other means of including online participants are equal in some sense. Well, they're not. Until we perfect hologram projection at the IGF, I think that WebEx is the preferred option, and that should be clearly stated. Alternatively, we could include people using audio only and resort to reading out text messages as a measure of last resort. I propose the wording which clearly advised the workshop proposers to have in mind the need to organize online participation via the WebEx platform. But that point was kind of lost in the adaptation. The reason why this change was proposed was the last year's experience, where a lot of workshop proposers just resorted to providing Twitter hashtag and thought they sorted out remote participation. So our host in Mexico will, of course, provide most of the rooms with the necessary technical means and provide technical assistance and volunteers. So let us use this. Let us not waste this opportunity. Thank you.
Thank you, Slotoban. Thank you. I think we said Michael was next. Zina online, and then we'll close there.
Just real quick, I was at this morning's meeting, and I was impressed with how few changes we made. This is a 1.5% change. You know, it's not. We did such a good job last year; we didn't have to do much to correct. I would say that encouraging people to use sophisticated remote participation tools is great. Mentioning a particular tool, WebEx instead of Skype or Google. I don't care. I work for Cloudflare, but it doesn't make sense to single out one.
Well, if I may clarify, I mean, we need to include people using voice, using video, as much, you know, dimensions as possible. So, I mean, that was my point. And, I mean, WebEx is readily available.
Okay, thank you, Slotoban.
Yeah, I think we should just use what is going to be available. We're not going to have everything available. We know for sure we're going to have WebEx available. We can have text, so we can list exactly what is going to be available. And I know Andrea doesn't like WebEx, but
online, that's not something we can resolve now. I mean, we'll let the Secretariat get back on the tools that are available to us that we can use.
But I mean, I'm sorry, but
I do have some other people in the queue, Slotoban, so okay. Please, briefly.
Well, we have, you know, this whole system of remote participation is wired in the transcription capabilities. So this is why I'm against, you know, using, you know, other means which are not supported, you know, in the system at the venue.
Yeah, that's what we're saying. We're going to list the things that are supported at the venue. And that's the only options that people will, and those are the only options that people will have. If we can improve them by then, of course, we will improve them, but we will list what we have, what is supported, sorry. It's not a free-for-all.
I had Zina in the queue. You have the floor.
Yes, thank you. I already sent in the morning an email regarding the probability of launching a competition on social media. I would kindly ask all the members to review this email and think about it seriously, because it can engage a lot of people, especially the young generation. When we talk about social media, they will be very interested and they will attend and participate, and we can elaborate on the idea if it's accepted by everyone.
Thank it's you. An interesting idea. Thank you. And we had an online participant.
Thank you. Ginger, you have the floor. Ginger, maybe you can try to speak now.
Hear me? I'm sorry. I thought I was unmuted. Can you confirm that you can hear me, please?
We can hear you.
Okay, I think it's very important that we revisit Slobodan's point, because it isn't any longer about the technology. I'm not going to argue about which platform we use. There are many good platforms we get from Luis Mobile. We get excellent support. The technology is now working. We have a problem in the organization and the strategy of the panel sessions, and that is a weak point still in the workshop instructions. So I think we must address it to make sure that workshop organizers and panel moderators understand that they have to, for instance, use the example of this meeting as a model to make sure that online participants have full and equal opportunity to join in. It's not the same to have Twitter. It's not the same to design a meeting anymore for just the people in the room. I could keep going on. You know that, but I will, for the sake of time, I'll stop now. But we must reinforce this point.
No, I think that was excellent, Ginger, and you couldn't be more clear. So I think that was good. What I'm hearing from the room then is that we probably need more time to review the output of the working group that came in this morning. No? I'm seeing people shaking their heads. I've been here. I haven't had time to look at it, so I'm trying to read the room in terms of, is the room comfortable saying we are okay with the documents as edited by this morning out of the working group? If so, we declare them closed.
Just one sentence we have to change.
Madam Chair, yeah, of the 55 MAG Excellent. Members, 33 are the existing MAG members. They already blessed these last year.
Excellent.
And of the 22 which have joined new, I think 17 have provided their inputs. If there are two more lines, including the very important input by Ginger, they should be sent in now, and we should please close this today.
Okay. So we will make the adjustment along the lines of what Ginger just suggested, whatever the one line was that Chengatai just said needed, yes. And we close will post those and have those ready to go. Juan?
Just one question. I didn't read the final document, but now if we are leaving the tagging to the end, should in the document on the revision of the workshop, should it be that the MAG member should suggest the tag or the theme for each workshop? Is that already in the document, or that's an update that we have to do to the document?
Flavia?
Yeah, the document was written before the decision, before the discussion here in the plenary, of course. So there are some comments on the document you may find that state that depending on the decision of the MAG here, this phrase should be rebuilt. Yeah, but this happens for three or four sentences along the documents.
And the room is confident that we can do that with the secretariat. Yeah. So I'm seeing lots of vigorous head nodding.
Yeah. The places that have been, that need to
declare those approved and closed. Okay. I'm going to turn the floor to Yolanda to say a few words. Wai Min, if you'd like to address you. And then I think it just remains to all of us applaud all the work we've done and for me to give my thanks to everybody. But Yolanda?
Well, thank you all. As Victor mentioned, it has been a very productive and learning experience for us since it's the first time that we participate in the MAC process. We would like also to express that it's not just only us. Behind us is a multi-stakeholder community in Mexico that is very excited to host IGF. So we are two persons that came all the way to Geneva, but behind us there's a very active multi-stakeholder ecosystem and community that is very conscious and anxious to receive all IGF delegates in Mexico. And as Victor mentioned, we are focusing a lot in having a technology-enabled forum. That means that operational issues like tagging or having technology-enabled remote participation and making sure that people with disability has enough tools to really take advantage of participating in the conference is going to be one of our priorities. And as we mentioned when we presented our candidacy in Joao Pessoa, we are very pleased of the theme of the conference because we want a forum that is very inclusive. And that means having a lot of participation from youth, from women, from older, from indigenous community, for people with disability. Internet came to stay. We live in a digital world, and we need to make sure that everyone is included in that process, and this forum gave us that opportunity. We're also very pleased, and we are conscious of the challenge that the venue has, but believe me, is the best example of how something that is a heritage site can host something that is the best for the future. So it's a beautiful space, it's open, it's ready to host a forum that looks for and promotes collaboration, openness, freedom of expression, and everyone should be welcome. We are a very hospitable country, so we are very happy to host IGF. And the reason to invite you to have a MAC meeting in Mexico is because of that. We have sponsors, we have a multi-stakeholder community that will be very active and sensible in having the opportunity to physically participate in a MAC meeting. We know we have remote options, but if you want to have, you know, high-level ministers and people that is important for us to host and to give us the support, just by telling them, you know, we're hosting a MAC meeting here X month, help us a lot in having the support that we need in organizing the meeting. And with that, I will also say that we are federal government, but we have the entire support from the state government as well, and that's something important to say. So thank you all, and see you in Mexico.
I'd like to add my thanks to everybody here as well. I think we pushed through an awful lot of work. I hope everybody feels comfortable, maybe just comfortable enough with that. We had an awful lot to get through, and obviously there are a lot of different opinions, but I think the work we've done in past years has stood us really well. I think the Secretariat is on top of a lot of the items that we are going to work to close over the next few days, and I'm confident we can get everything out and meet our deadline. So I really want to thank everybody for their support, and particularly for making this job, you know, relatively easy, actually. I think there was a lot of support for pushing through, you know, in the areas we needed to. So I thank those that went with it. I'd like to thank the scribes. Again, I think just superb work. And I know I've gone back every night, so I'd like to thank the secretary for posting it so quickly as well, and used it to get organized and settle for the next day. So I think that's been extremely useful. And of course, to thank the interpreters as well. Very, very useful, and appreciate the effort. And we're almost ending on time. And I think the final thanks is to the Secretariat. I mean, there's a lot of work that goes into supporting this before the meeting, during the meeting, after the meeting, 7:30 last night, they're still here finalizing things. So, I mean, I think it shows in the quality of the work, and I really just like to thank everybody for everything they've done to make this a success. Thank you.
Actually, I'll thank the chair. I mean, it's for the first meeting, and I think she did a very great job. Thank you very much.
Yeah, Arret. Marilyn, did you have an? Marilyn has a short social announcement, so we are officially
Thank
done.
You, Chair. I would like to propose, for those of you who are still around, although it's informal and it's not scheduled, that we gather at the Ariana restaurant, which is just down the hill. They have a back room, and we can buy pizza and beer and wine, and if people will chip in a little bit of money, like 10 or 12 Swiss francs, I will twist the arm of my colleague Marcus Coomer from IGFSA and of CHERIC, and we will pick up the rest of it. And it'll be informal, it'll be standing room only. It's not organized, but I think it'd be a great way to just socially toast the great working progress that we've made and the convening of the first MAG. And Chair, I'm sorry, I have only one favor to ask you. Could you please instruct the staff not to work, but to come with us?